I'm gonna be round my vegetables. I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to day two of the Variety Showcase. My name is Jay Bost. I'm from GoFarm, Hawaii. So I'm broadcasting from out here in Waimanalo on the island of Oahu. And we have an exciting lineup for you guys today. We're going to start in Maine and then work our way to the West Coast and have a lot of exciting talks going from squash to barley to the history of seed catalogs and then to some basics of breeding with Organic Seed Alliance. So our first video that we're going to watch today, and then we'll have Lindsay Wyatt with us live to answer questions, is about Kabocha breeding at Johnny's. And this is by Lindsay Wyatt, who's the cucurbit breeder at Johnny's. She completed her graduate work at Cornell working on peppers and cucurbits, and I had the pleasure to get to know Lindsay over the years through the Student Organic Seed Symposium, and she's now active with the Society of Organic Seed Professionals. So we're going to delve right into a fun video to learn about their work, and then we'll get Lindsay on here with us to answer any questions that you guys might have after the video. So as you're watching it, just feel free to type questions into YouTube, and we'll ask Lindsay after our video that's about 13, 14 minutes long. Enjoy.
Hello, I'm Lindsay Wyatt. I am a squash and pumpkin breeder at Johnny's Selected Seeds, which is a seed company here in Albion, Maine. At Johnny's, our mission is helping families, friends, and communities to feed one another by providing superior seeds, tools, information, and service. Here at Johnny's, I develop new varieties of summer squash, winter squash, and pumpkins, along with my two squash team members, Emily Stark and Steve Savoy, and a fantastic group of summer pollination crew workers. At Johnny's, we do all of our work under organically managed conditions so that we can develop squash that perform well for our organic grower customers. And we focus on squash that tastes great and are easy to grow. In our kabocha breeding program at Johnny's, we work on all sorts of different types. We work on a range of sizes from small to large, and we work on a variety of colors such as red, pink, green, and gray. We focus on mainly breeding hybrid kabochas here, which means we spend several years doing self-pollinations year after year to develop inbred lines that we use as parents. And then we make lots of different combinations of those new parent lines to find the very best hybrids we can then put in our catalog. Each year we grow about 6 acres of squash and pumpkins, so kabochas are a subset of that. And we have a great pollination crew who spends their summer doing self-pollinations of thousands of plants. That allows me to then go through and select the very best ones at the end of the season to save seed from. Within these 6 acres, we also grow more than 100 plots of kabocha hybrids. This includes our brand new hybrids we're testing for the first time, advanced varieties that have already made it through several years of testing, and comparison varieties, including ones that we sell and ones that are sold by other seed companies. We take a lot of data on these hybrids, including plant vigor, disease resistance, fruit size, shape, and color, and yield. We then take the best plots and bring them inside for further testing. This testing includes storage evaluations to make sure that we release varieties that store for a long time without getting a lot of rot happening or drying out or color fading. We also do a lot of culinary evaluations. So this includes taking data on the bricks and dry matter of the fruit to predict sweetness and texture, and taste testing, of course. Today, we're excited to tell you all about our kabocha breeding program here at Johnny's.
So I wanted to talk a little bit about why we love kabochas here and why we breed kabochas at Johnny's. I've been here about 7 years. When I first came to Johnny's, I didn't know much at all about kabocha squash. Had eaten some buttercups, which are very similar, but didn't have much of an opinion on it. It was Rob Johnson that first turned me on to kabochas. He would come into the lunchroom and eat roasted kabocha squash for lunch a lot of the time. And I took a real liking to it. And I think what I love most about kabocha squash is that they're sort of a standalone squash, whereas I think of butternuts as more of an ingredient for soups and other types of dishes, ravioli. Kabocha you can roast pretty much as they are with a little bit of seasoning, and they're just a wonderful eating experience. I love the texture. They're dry, kind of like a baked potato, but very, very sweet and have a really nutty flavor and a little bit more depth to the flavor than I think most other squashes. So there's something that I really look forward to eating in the fall and into the winter. I also love that a good kabocha squash can store for a long time, which is a big emphasis of our breeding program. And I like that you can eat the skin, so you don't have to peel it. It's a much easier thing to deal with. But really, it's the flavor. So today I'm going to share with you one of my favorite dishes. If you get on the Johnny's website, you can see a video that I did a few years ago for a miso glazed kabocha squash, which I had for Thanksgiving this year, and it was lovely. But my go-to breakfast during the winter season is kabocha squash and eggs. I'm very fortunate, being involved in a kabocha squash breeding program, that I always have plenty of squash nearby. And so this is something that I love to eat for breakfast. Kabochas are really big in Japan. They grow a lot of them in Hokkaido on the northern island. There are two primary types. There's a wet type and a dry type. Here at Johnny's, we focus primarily on the dry types. The wet types are a little mushy. You'll know when you've found one. So what I've got roasting in here is Winter Sweet, which is our sort of flagship kabocha. It's a silver color, stores very long, and is very, very dry and delicious. So without further ado here, I'm going to get cooking. Alright, so I've been roasting these. This is just a half a kabocha, cut in half again, and each quarter brushed with olive oil and a little salt and pepper, and roasted at mostly 400 degrees and a little bit hotter to finish it. So we'll grab one of these. And this is a little bigger portion than I'm used to eating, but we'll cut this in half. Look at that. Two eggs on top and breakfast of champions.
Hi, so we're here at the Green Kabocha, and part of what we're looking at when we evaluate any of our squash is its flavor. So the first part of that is that we cut the fruit in half. So we're going to cut this kabocha, this green kabocha, in half, and I start by taking off the stem. All right, so we're going to take a photo of this green kabocha. We're going to put one side upright, so we can see the color of the flesh and the seed cavity and the shape inside of there. And then the other half we're going to put down so we can see the skin color. All take the photo, we're going to take two samples. One is going to be for taking a brick sample, and one's going to be to look at the dry matter. So... usually just cut two wedges. We like to take a chunk from the same part of each fruit so that's consistent. So I'm gonna take a section right here. And for the dry matter, we don't need the skin in there. Squeeze this so we don't mind if there's skin on it. And then after that, we're done with the fruit, and we can show you the next steps for these two kinds of samples.
So we're taking bricks samples for these because Brix measures the sugar content and that predicts the sweetness. So it's a really important flavor component for squash. I'm gonna squeeze each sample to get some of the juice to come out and then cut a little hole and use a digital refractometer that measures Brix. So once we have the dry matter sample, we'll take its weight when it's wet and record that, and then we'll put it into our drying oven for about 5 days until it's totally dried out, and then we'll take the dry weight. Here's a sample that's been fully dried out. So then we'll record that weight, and from that we can determine the starch content, the dry matter, which is correlated to the starch content, which then can predict the texture of the squash.
We can predict the sweetness and texture of the squash using our Brix and dry matter measurements, but that doesn't tell the whole picture of flavor. So we do a lot of taste testing. Here we have our gray kabocha taste test for the day. You can see these nice wedges that we've cut of our fruit here. And then we're just gonna take this and simply steam them in the microwave. We taste all of our squash steamed in the microwave because that is a straightforward method of cooking that lets us make sure we release things that taste good no matter how you prepare them. So they're friendly for all cooking levels. All right, here we have our squash. It has been cooked in the microwave. And now I'm going to taste it. We have a simple rating system where we look at the texture of the squash and the sweetness and the overall likability, how much we like it or not. And those all get rated on a 1 to 9 scale. And then we can write any comments that we have about the flavor or the color, or anything like that. That was a good one.
So one of the most important things that we look at is storage. So we're looking at the butternuts to make sure that they're not gonna dry out, that they're not rotting. And then for kabochas, we're looking at their color retention in storage, if they rot. And for acorns, we're also looking at their color retention.
I'm excited to share with you three upcoming varieties from our kabocha breeding program. This first variety is Winter Blush. It's this lovely pink color, and it has some really pretty blue modeling. We think that's really lovely. It's a standard kabocha size, so it can pair well with Winter Sweet, one of our favorites that we currently offer, and look great in farmers market displays. It stores quite well like Winter Sweet, so you can eat it December through March, or maybe even longer. And it has a really great texture and flavor like all of our kabochas. Next, we have this new small gray-green kabocha. The small size of this, the fruits average about 1 1/4 pounds, makes it really great for single meals or even to make stuffed squash. You can just cut off the tops and have little single size portions. This squash stores well, and it looks really lovely into storage. It retains its color really nicely. And it's ready to eat in about November and will last for several months after that. Last, we have this lovely coral medium kabocha. We really love this bright coral color, which is really unique. And we love the medium size. It's good for small households, and it packs really well into CSA boxes, which can be useful for our growers. This is unique because even though it has this reddish-orange color family color, it stores much longer into the fall and winter than the average red or orange kabocha. This kabocha is still in the testing phase, but hopefully it'll be in your catalogs in fall of 2022. Both of these squash are coming out in our catalog in the fall of 2021, so stay tuned.
All right. We're going to get Lindsay on here. Hi, Lindsay. How's it going?
Great. How are you?
I'm good. Thanks so much for that video. Making probably everyone hungry. We've got some different recipes and ideas folks putting into the chat box. One question that we had right away is from one of our speakers yesterday. I don't know if you had a chance to watch. Klaus was asking, when do you do those different evaluations that you're doing? Is that determined by like days after pollination or days in storage? Like, what's the kind of timing mark of when you do those?
Yeah, that's a great question. We aim to evaluate the squash, whether it's the bricks and dry matter or the taste testing, when people should be eating it. So, you know, we start with acorn squash and delicatas and do those in late October, because that's as soon as we have time once we're done with our jack-o'-lanterns. And then we move on to some of the small kabochas and the red kabochas, and then butternuts and larger size kabochas in December and January. And if things are more advanced, we try and taste them at the beginning of the recommended eating interval, then again at the end of the recommended eating interval to make sure that it tastes good throughout that entire time.
Okay. So the ones that you are showing us, and it sounds like a lot of the ones that you are working on are hybrids. And I was wondering, do you guys focus on that because of yield, or is it for uniformity, or what is the logic behind you guys focusing on doing the hybrids? It seems like on the one hand, more work, but there must be a reason for that and a good end result.
Yeah, I think you listed two of the best reasons, the yield and uniformity. And also we can just get a greater diversity of sizes and colors more quickly. So, you know, you can combine a really small one and a large one, of course, and that's how we get that smaller gray-green one, which is now named Sweet Jade since the filming of the video. And so, yeah, it just provides us a larger toolbox and a lot of options for creating a lot of diverse kabochas.
And then what about different disease issues that you focus on? I mean, probably there's some that are all across your cucurbit project, or there's some that are more specific to the kabocha and the maximas?
There's not any one particular disease that's specific to the kabochas, but the one disease we rate really carefully for is powdery mildew resistance. So I take ratings on that, and then I take ratings on just general health. So I try to release things that have been shown to be vigorous in our organic growing conditions. So that should stand up well to conditions in other places.
Mm-hmm. And then your breeding, how much do you tap into, like, are you pulling in OP varieties ever? Or are you guys ever tapping into like Grin's germplasm collections? Or we heard yesterday about interspecific crosses, bringing things in from other species. Is that, you know, something that you're doing or are interested in?
Yeah, we have not done a lot of that yet. I inherited a lot of wonderful material when I started at Johnny's, and I've been enjoying looking through all of that rich diversity. And another really great source that's our primary one bringing into things into the program right now is university breeding programs. So the University of New Hampshire, Dr. Brent Loy, had wonderful material. We have a lot of Kabocha material from him that's really excellent, and Cornell as well. Mm-hmm. But I think we'll certainly in the future be looking to Grin and other sources to see what it has to offer.
So you guys start doing your trials there, you know, picking which ones to release, and then what happens before you release them? Do you have like a trial network throughout the country to kind of see how things are going to work out in different ecosystems?
Yeah, that's a really important piece of the process. So we grow things for usually about 3 years on our farm to make sure that it's good enough to send to other people, because it's usually people we're sending it to are trying to make a living off of growing that squash, among other things. So then we love university trials and other nonprofit group trials, like the Novik trials have been really wonderful to be a part of. I think we're going to have some squash in there again this year, which is great. And then grower trials. So we have a regional trials coordinator here at Johnny's, Luke, who has a great grower network and some really fantastic partners.
And with the Kabochas in particular, do you end up finding that those do better in certain parts of the country with certain, you know, weather conditions or, you know, moisture? Like, are those more appropriate for certain places?
Yeah, they're, you know, we haven't done as much trialing in the South, for example. Mm-hmm. So I guess I'm not as sure how they do there compared to, you know, places in the North. It's been really interesting with Alex Stone's dry farming squash data to see how some of our varieties do in that system. And I've been surprised at how much I can see the yields vary too from place to place. But I have found that rankings in terms of eating quality seem to stay the same. So the ones that we promote because they have really excellent eating quality seem to do well, like across the Novik region, for example, in the northern part of the country.
Okay.
But I always want more of that data, and hopefully in the coming years we'll get more and more trial partners to keep learning.
It's pretty fun and impressive to see you know, your guys' barcoding and the camera set up. I mean, it's obvious that you guys are getting things streamlined. That's fun to see. We had another question that was asking if the trend in Kabocha breeding is towards like the semi-bush type, or is it like still the strongly vining type?
I think both. We're looking at both, and it really depends on the system that the grower is using. So, you know, the really long vines are great for weed suppression, but if you want to fit a lot of different plants in a home garden, for example, then I wouldn't want to grow a Kabocha that's making 20-foot vines. So yeah, we are exploring all of the different options because we want to support our grower customers, our, you know, commercial grower customers and our home garden customers.
That's exciting. So you have sort of, you like identify something as like, okay, this is a really good semi-bush variety, and you'll market it as that. This is a really good vining one, and just let people know for those different types of systems.
Yeah, I guess for Kabocha, vining would be the default. So we would just mention if it was unusually compact. Yep.
Okay. Do you have anything you can share your perspective being at Johnny's? You know, I think many of us are Johnny's customers and have noticed it's hard to buy right now as a, if you're not a commercial account. Like, what have you experienced as, you know, in your, I guess it's not probably affecting your breeding program as much, but, you know, supply issues with some of the squash you've been working on, and what's that like being in the seed industry right now, where there's so much excitement, but then also like, oh, geez, our production is not keeping up.
Yeah, well, actually, the good news is we are, I don't think we're in danger of running out of any seeds. The bottleneck is getting them into the right size packets and getting them out the door. And we've hired a huge amount of people, way more than ever before. But with so many people interested in gardening, which is awesome, it's just creating a lot of demand. So I think people should not worry about being able to get seeds. It's just a matter of timing. And we really value all of our customers. And the people in our warehouse are hustling and have been hustling for months. And I really appreciate their work.
That's cool. Do you have, we've got a few minutes left. Anything on your mind that you want to let us know about?
Well, one thing I've been thinking about, and if anyone wants to chime in the chat, is taste testing methods. So there's a lot of debate over the best way to taste test. So is it the way that we do it, you know, the absolute most simple, steamed in the microwave? Or should it be a little bit more elaborate, like roasting? Do you put salt and oil on your samples? Do you not? And with COVID, we actually had a chance to test out some of that, because instead of doing our taste tests at work all the time, we took them home and did taste testing. So I did some taste tests this year, roasted with salt and oil. And I guess what I found is pretty much everything tasted good when I made it that way. So, you know, how do you interpret those results? You know, do you release everything because it all tastes good like that? But I know that there are differences, and very real ones, in how, you know, they taste if you just steam them. So I don't think there's a right answer, but it's an interesting question to ponder.
Yeah. And then in terms of, it's the dry matter that determines how much when you cook it, it's going to like stay kind of solid versus get mushy and fall apart. And so in kabocha in general, that's what you guys, there's like a definite cutoff point where you don't want it to go below that. Is there a high point of dry matter where it starts getting so starchy that you get that like stuck in your throat kind of feeling and you need some pretty serious sauce?
Yeah. So, we don't have a low cutoff, but usually I'll try and select for higher dry matter. And then you can't have it be too high, but that's all relative to when you're eating the squash. So as a squash is stored, it's, you know, a living thing and it's metabolizing. So it's taking the starch and turning it into sugars. So if you ate, for example, winter sweet, one of our kabochas in October, it would taste terrible, because it would be really dry and really crumbly and not sweet. But if you store it until December and even into March or later, that starch will have started to metabolize into sugars. It's kind of like a banana ripening, really. Mm-hmm. Same process. And that's why we recommend different eating intervals for the squash, is so you can eat it when it has the right balance of starch and sugar.
But that texture, the texture will still stay, you know, relatively, you know, like get that kind of crumbly, like it stays in chunks versus getting falling apart even after the storage? Or does that start to change some as the starches turn to sugars?
It changes. So if you stored a kabocha for like a year, it would be pretty mushy by then, and more like a butternut or something like that. That's a little more watery.
So interesting, all the work to be done on these windows, like you gotta let store enough but not too much. That's fun and exciting. So that's cool to know you guys are, you know, collaborating with Novik and Alex Stone, doing so much neat work on, and with Lane on the storage. And it was fun seeing you at the last in-person variety showcase. That kind of for me was like the last hurrah before migrating into Zoom world. But I guess the good thing about this is we're having a lower carbon footprint, but all still getting together and getting to share. But hopefully we'll get to see you in person before too long.
Yeah, well, thanks so much.
Thank you. And feel free to hang out on YouTube. We've got some more fun talks coming up. Thanks again. Good to see you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, everybody. Now we're going to move on to our next presenter, who is Alice Formiga, who I have never really gotten to know and had actually never seen until a couple of weeks ago. We did a really fun week of winter squash with the Culinary Breeding Network and got to see Alice for the first time. And to me, she's kind of like the Terry Gross of sustainable agriculture. I feel like I know her because I've heard her voice so many times introducing things on eOrganic. And so it's been fun to finally put a face to the voice I've been hearing for so many years. Alice is now at Oregon State University and obviously does a lot with eOrganic, but has an interesting background, having done variety trials at Renee's Garden and also Shepherd's Seed. And so she's been involved in, you know, a lot of actual trialing of vegetables, and then got a MS in library science, and obviously likes investigating things and getting into archives, and wrote a website, which I assume will find out about how to access of a collection of seed and nursery catalogs at Oregon State University. And if you haven't seen it, make sure to check out her talk at Winter Squash Week about the history of squash in art. But we have actually a nice long presentation that we're gonna watch that Alice did. And I don't know if you want to say anything before we get started, Alice. It's great to see you.
Great to see you, Jay.
Okay. All right. Nice background there.
Thank you.
Yeah, I guess we'll jump right in, and just like with Lindsay's, feel free to put questions as we go into the chat, and we will get back with questions after walking through history.
Hello, this is Alice Formiga of Oregon State University, and I'm going to be talking about the history of seed and nursery catalogs. Mostly, I'll be showing you pictures of seed and plant catalogs and how they've changed over time. We'll see some examples from the Oregon State University Valley Library Special Collection of about 2,000 seed and nursery catalogs from the early 1800s to the 1960s. And if you see a little beaver logo next to a picture here, that means that the catalog is in that collection. Most of these catalogs are from England and the United States, so I'm going to focus mostly on those two countries. Finally, I'll talk about the seed and nursery catalog today, and I'll give you some examples of where you can find historic seed and plant catalogs online. So why can it be interesting to look at older seed and nursery catalogs? Maybe you're a gardener or a cook and you're interested in heirloom vegetables and you'd like to know when they were first introduced. Or maybe you'd like to know what types of plants and other garden products were available in the past. In its most basic form, a seed and nursery catalog would just be a list of seeds and plants for sale. But today we really expect a whole lot more from a seed catalog. We expect to see a good selection. We expect the catalogs to be filled with information on how to grow the plants. We expect an order form. We expect the products to arrive on time. And we expect a good description of the plant along with a colorful illustration or photograph. And we often expect the catalog to inspire us. Reading seed catalogs can be a yearly ritual and can bring back memories of childhood. As a New York Times article recently put it, it can almost be like having a visit from an old friend. But we might not think about how these things that we expect might be really different from what was in the first catalogs about 400 years ago. So what were those catalogs like? Let's go back to about 1612 or so in Holland. Back then, most people exchanged seeds and plants, or they bought them at markets or maybe in a store. At that time, though, many new plants were arriving from all over the world, and it was very fashionable for rich people to have collections of rare plants. Sometimes kings or queens or rich merchants would employ artists to illustrate their plant collections with beautiful engravings and put them in books called florilegia,
The first known plant catalog was a florilegium from 1612 by a flower merchant named Emanuel Swirtz, and it is not only an illustration of his plant collection, but it also shows what he could provide for sale. Another catalog like that is the Hortus Floridus by Crispin de Pass from 1614. This book was translated into different languages and it was used as a reference book. And it was also used by both the author and other plant merchants to show what they could provide for sale. This is the first known French catalog of plants from René Morin of Paris from 1621. You can see that it doesn't illustrate the individual plants, but it has some abbreviations over here, which tell you which seasons the plants flowered in. And this kind of thing was really helpful for seed and plant sellers because otherwise the customer might complain if the plant didn't bloom right away or if it didn't bloom when they expected it to. This here is supposedly the first English plant catalog from Robert Ferber of Kensington, which is now part of London. He also produced the first illustrated English plant catalog called 12 Months of Flowers in 1730. And this was in the form of these beautiful engravings, which you could order by subscription, either black and white or painted in color. The flowers aren't illustrated individually, but they're shown in these beautiful bouquets. And 2 years later, he produced this catalog, which is similar, called 12 Months of Fruit. In England, networks of canals expanded in the 1700s, so transportation became a little bit easier, and more seed and plant catalogs appeared outside of London. In 1775, the first catalog of plants with prices listed was published. More people who weren't necessarily quite as rich as the London customers of Robert Ferber wanted to buy trees and plants and seeds, and they might have lived further away from the nursery, so they couldn't just stop by. And so they naturally wanted to know the price before they sent in an order. Around the same time, there were more seed catalogs, and most of them weren't illustrated, but they often had Latin and common names and charts with information on the plant and maybe some brief growing instructions. After 1830, when railroad transportation improved, annual seed catalogs became much more common in England. In 1837, the year of Queen Victoria's coronation, the firm of James Carter issued their first annual catalog. And this company basically became the standard of seed catalogs that were issued annually in England for many years, and it inspired many American catalogs as well. The Oregon State University Library has a scanned catalog from this company from 1841, and you can read the whole thing on their website. So let's take a look inside. You can see that you're given instructions on how to pronounce the Latin names, and has charts over here that show some botanical information, as well as the hardiness, the color, the height, the month of flowering, and the price. Here you can see some of the vegetables in his catalog. There's a pretty large variety of lettuce here, lots of different peas, including a lot of marrow peas, and all these different color radishes. He's got red, salmon, white, purple, yellow, olive shaped, and black. And storage crops were really important back then, especially since there wasn't refrigeration in every house. So the earliest American catalogs were from the Eastern Seaboard. Some of the best known ones are the Prince Nursery from Flushing, New York. This is their 1771 catalog. They sold fruit trees, and it was a printed sheet called a broadsheet, and so was this one, which was a catalog from 1804 by Bernard McMahon or Maman, and it's sometimes spelled both ways. He supplied seeds to Thomas Jefferson and also sold plants from the Lewis and Clark expedition. So here are some of the many varieties of cabbages that he sold. And here you can see that he sold physical herbs, which were medicinal herbs. And he sold the love apple in this category, which is the tomato. Many Northern Europeans didn't really consider the tomato to be a healthy vegetable, and many people actually thought it was poisonous. This is the catalog. It's one of the oldest ones in the OSU collection of Grant Thorburn from New York City. He opened one of New York's earliest seed companies. He was an immigrant from Scotland, and he ended up running a shop in New York. He had started selling seeds when someone came to his shop in 1805 with a seed catalog, and he studied it carefully, and then he decided to make his own catalog and change the sowing times for New York. And then he started a seed farm, which then went bust, and he had to spend a year in debtor's prison. But then after he got out, he became very successful. And here are some of the vegetables in his catalog. Corn, which was domesticated by Native Americans and was such an important crop, might have been familiar in Scotland to Grant Thorburn, but probably not all the diversity of different varieties that there were in America. So here you can see that he describes a couple of different types as curious. And here he has a pretty typical selection of squash from the early 19th century. This one here, the acorn squash, is not the acorn squash that we know today, but it was actually a type of turban squash. And then this one, Commodore Porter squash, I don't even think that's available today anymore, but back then you see it in a lot of catalogs. That was a large Cucurbita maxima variety that probably came over to America after the War of 1812. Thorburn also lists medicinal herbs and lists what they're good for. Back then, there were a lot of epidemics, and there wasn't really a lot of standardized medicine, so herbs were very important. And here you can see that he actually also sold some dried herbs that were packaged by the Shaker community. Thorburn also catered to ladies. It was considered very proper at that time for ladies to have gardens and press flowers and learn about botany. Thorburn said that this would be a better activity for ladies than making sentimental scrapbooks. And he even said that if you had a well-tended garden, then your husband might stay home rather than go out drinking in a tavern. But he also devoted three pages to the language of flowers, also aimed at ladies. And that was the idea that you could have bouquets of flowers with hidden messages. He also sells other fashionable items from that time, like canaries and crocus pots in the form of hedgehogs and beehives. Thorburn also produced the first illustration in an American seed catalog that we know of. This one was used in several of his catalogs. This one comes from 1820, and it's just a kind of a generic picture of a greenhouse. The OSU collection has a lot of, not a lot, but a good selection of interesting catalogs from the 1840s and 50s, and some of them are starting to offer mail order. And mail order back then was a little more complicated than it is today, because there wasn't rural free delivery everywhere, and the transportation networks in America really weren't that well built up. There were some railroads at the time, as well as omnibuses, which are mentioned here. However, if you wanted to ship something all the way to the West Coast, you might have to use a stagecoach express company, or ship things around Cape Horn, or overland through Central America, and then up the Pacific coast. So it really wasn't so easy, but some of these companies still, in spite of all those difficulties, do offer packing and shipping to any place outside of Boston. Here are some of the things that are available in those catalogs. We see some pumpkins, that some of which are available today, like the large cheese pumpkin, that's a Cucurbita machata variety. Then we have the Connecticut field pumpkin and the mammoth pumpkin. The tomato here is becoming much more widespread and accepted in all of American society. It says here that they're a very wholesome vegetable, and properly cooked, they're considered a great luxury. And so here are some instructions on how to prepare it. Seed companies didn't just cater to home gardeners, but they also catered to truck farmers. And there were many truck farmers outside of American cities and small farmers everywhere. So these books, which were published by seed company owners, like this one by Peter Henderson, also functioned as catalogs because they listed all the varieties that the authors sold. After the Civil War is when the seed industry really expanded across the United States. Railroads and changes in mail were very important here. In the late 1860s, the Postal Service lowered the cost of shipping seeds and cuttings and also the price of shipping catalogs. So catalogs started getting much larger, and they also started getting more competitive with many more illustrations and pressure to offer new varieties each year. There were many more catalogs all over the United States because of those transportation issues that I mentioned before. It made sense that, you know, as European settlers moved further west, more seed companies sprung up with them. So in some of these late 19th century catalogs, you start seeing more exaggerated claims about giant vegetables and huge double flowers. Most of the illustrations up until the very end of the 19th century were still in black and white, and some of them were really beautifully done. The first color print was probably in the 1864 catalog of James Vick, but there were several companies introducing color around the same time. And you can see some of the earliest color prints really aren't the best quality. This one is nicer than this one here. This one's a little bit messy. Some other things that were interesting from the catalogs at this time, we have round tomatoes. Before this, most of the tomatoes in catalogs could have been more ribbed, and the Livingston Company introduced a lot of round tomato varieties. Also, the James Gregory catalog was really instrumental in popularizing several varieties of Cucurbita maxima squash, like the Hubbard squash, which they introduced, and the Turban squash. Let's see, some other things that were interesting in the late 19th century. There are lots of sweet peas. There was a real craze for sweet peas at the end of the 19th century. And in the beginning of the 20th century, when the first Spencer ruffled variety was introduced in 1901, many, many catalogs list huge numbers of varieties of sweet peas. There are also many more flowering plants, especially after people in America became a little bit less preoccupied completely with subsistence, then they want to have ornamental plants in their gardens as well. Many more plants are designed for decorating your property. As the railroads expanded, then there were more suburbs, and people wanted to have shrubs and flowers and lawns. In England, there were still some landowners that had very fancy gardens and lawns on their large estates, so some catalogs catered to them. And on both sides of the ocean, many more catalogs specialized in particular types of garden plants like roses. So here's some examples of early photography in seed catalogs. You can tell that some of them really aren't that great quality. So very often illustrations were much better at selling plants than these early photographs. But here are some early examples. Here's some photographs from a catalog from Japan that also sold to customers in the United States. And you can see some of the plants being prepared for shipping. And this is a really nice color photograph of delphiniums from a upscale British nursery at in the early 20th century. And the photographs are finally getting to be much better quality. So here are some catalogs from the late 19th century from the USDA National Agricultural Library collection. The OSU collection doesn't really have a whole lot of these really beautiful covers, but the late 19th century up until about World War I was considered the golden age of seed catalog art. And you can really see these very elaborate covers. And here are some of these giant vegetables. This one has a crown on it. Here's a giant cabbage, giant radishes, large double hollyhocks, and here are some sweet peas over here. Another sort of strange thing about catalogs that I noticed when looking at these is that many more of them have images of people. And these people really don't reflect the diversity of all the different people in the United States who were involved in agriculture and selling seeds and plants. Many of them have these sort of idealized pictures of white male farmers, and the women appear often as either goddesses or fine ladies, and the children appear as little angels. But you do sometimes also get these very stereotypical images of Japanese women wearing kimonos and holding umbrellas to advertise plants like these imperial Japanese morning glories. Catalogs of the late 19th century also offered many tools. For example, these mowers here. This one looks pretty heavy. It says oil often. And this is the new model Buckeye mower. It's horse-powered with new and important improvements. You can also see how specialized horticulture had become by this time. This catalog from a very upscale British nursery offers so many different types of garden knives and scissors. Here's some pest control products, and you can even get some medium Yorkshire pigs. World War I really had a very dramatic effect on seed and nursery companies, particularly in Europe. Many of the gardeners and workers in British seed companies and nursery companies were sent to fight in the trenches, and many of them never returned. Customers were encouraged by seed companies and by the government to be more self-sufficient and grow war gardens. Fewer large landowners in England after World War I could afford to maintain their extravagant gardens. Catalogs became less elaborate on less expensive paper, but there still are many specialty catalogs for plants, for borders, and also for people who competed in flower shows. Right after World War I, some catalogs promoted their charitable contributions to funds for disabled soldiers, such as this one, which is selling poppies for that purpose. In America, the First World War cut off imports of seeds and plants from Europe, so this really stimulated domestic production, particularly in California, where many more flowers were grown. Some companies, like this one, Gill Brothers Seed of Portland, Oregon, began to offer regionally adapted varieties of vegetables. Here's some catalogs from the 1920s and 30s. In the 1920s, there are more mention of gasoline-powered machinery and more artificial fertilizers for sale because horse manure was getting not quite as readily available. The hardships of the Depression are visible in the catalogs of the 1930s. Several British catalogs offered staple seeds of foods like cabbages and beets, as well as flower bulbs at discounted prices. Some companies that produced bulbs said that they employed British labor, especially in England. And another interesting thing about catalogs from 1930s is this one here. It's called Vegetables for Epicures, and it was produced by George Bunyard of a fruit tree nursery. And this contains a selection of vegetables chosen exclusively for flavor and cooking qualities, which is really unusual for that time. I don't know of anything else like this. And you can see a pretty wide range of different types of illustrations. You see black and white drawings, you see beautiful colored watercolors, you see color photographs, which are improving in quality here. So there's a real range. And this catalog here is one of the first American catalogs that produced hybrid corn. And after World War II, you start seeing many more F1 hybrid vegetables. In World War II, the sacrifices of the British public are really reflected in their seed and plant catalogs. Some seed company facilities were bombed. Paper was rationed, so many catalogs are smaller and contain fewer flower varieties because more land was being used for food. English catalogs promoted the Dig for Victory campaign, and one even offered a gardening pamphlet called Plots Against Hitler. In the US, catalogs encourage customers to plant victory gardens, and this Burpees catalog contains a selection of seed varieties for victory gardens. So most of the catalogs in the OSU collection from after 1945 are from the United States. They celebrated the end of the war with exuberant, colorful flower pictures, and they encouraged customers to settle down and grow more flowers to decorate home sweet home. According to an article on the Burpees catalog website, this catalog from 1945 shows a subliminal victory message with this V-shaped Swiss chard plant and some carrot bombs over some globe-shaped tomatoes. catalogs welcomed back servicemen, and they had plant variety names that commemorated historic events, like this rose, which is called the Peace Rose, which was named for the founding of the United Nations. The OSU collection also contains a number of catalogs from 1948 to 1960s, really wide variety from a lot of different companies. This one shows some 1950s people here, and these two show some modern garden centers. There are still many specialty varieties devoted to particular plants like roses. These catalogs celebrate the 50th or 100th or 150th anniversary of these companies. This catalog from Oscar Will is pretty unusual because it shows Native Americans, and they sold a lot of varieties that they had received from Native Americans. And here is a burpee catalog showing a number of different hybrid vegetables. So the seed catalogs that are more recent have some developments which I think distinguish them from some of the early catalogs before the 1960s. After the 1980s, since the 1980s, there's a lot more international and culturally diverse selections of seeds and plants in catalogs. There are a lot of heirloom varieties and improved heirloom varieties, and there are catalogs published by a nonprofit organization that are devoted to the conservation and preservation of seed varieties as well as seed sovereignty. Some examples include the Seed Savers Exchange and Native Seed Search. There are more F1 hybrids of vegetables in other catalogs, and there have been a lot of changes in patents and terms of use. Some companies demonstrate their environmental sustainability or their charitable generosity. There are some catalogs that have certified organic seeds or advertise the fact that they don't sell GMO seeds. And there are more seeds and plant varieties for pollinators, birds, butterflies, and native plants. And since 1994, we have the internet. So when I first started writing the website for the OSU exhibition of seed and nursery catalogs, I wondered what would happen to the printed seed catalog in the internet age. Would it become obsolete, and would it still be worth it for seed companies to produce them? So since I haven't really worked in the seed business for some time, I asked Renee Shepherd, who runs Renee's Garden Seeds where I used to work, about her thoughts on this. And she said that, as was the case 20 years ago, most people still buy seeds by going into a store or garden center. And they don't necessarily order through catalogs for the majority of their seeds, but most retail companies still produce catalogs, and they're not going away, and they're still a really important part of companies' marketing plans. What is different, though, is that companies don't use catalogs as much to prospect for new customers. Printing and mailing catalogs is expensive, and now digital advertising and mailing list optimization is very important for seed companies. So are online newsletters and blogs, as well as YouTube and social media. But you can still get a catalog from many companies if you request one, and often you can get one if you subscribe to an online mailing list or place an online order. Many people like to read their catalogs and then order online. So what I noticed when I was looking on the internet is that there are many small companies that are able to do business because of the web. And also, when I looked at some seed company websites, I realized how great they are at complementing the printed catalog. Some of them really have excellent growing guides, and they have insect and pest identification guides, recipes, blogs, how-to videos, garden plans for different regions, really incredible information that you certainly couldn't fit into one printed catalog. So the internet hasn't replaced the seed and plant catalog, but they both play an important role in marketing and selling seeds. So I just want to leave you with some places where you can find examples of online collections of historic seed and nursery catalogs. There are many libraries and museums and botanic gardens that have digitized seed catalog collections, or maybe they just show the catalog covers. The Biodiversity Heritage Library has a lot of entire catalogs that are shown online. And then there's the Internet Archive, and then Google Books, and then WorldCat, which is a catalog of what's in many libraries around the world, can sometimes be useful for finding the location of old catalogs if they have been cataloged by the library that they're in. So thank you very much for listening today, and I look forward to all your questions.
Wow, Alice, that was really fascinating. I have a huge list of my own questions. I'm waiting for them to start coming in by YouTube, but I'm wondering if you can clarify for us the OSU collection, that was like an exhibit or that's a collection, like we can just go online and like search that and access what you've written and search in that?
Absolutely. Yeah. In fact, a lot of the talk was taken from what I wrote on that. It's a digital exhibition. And all you have to do is Google seed catalog history, and it should come up pretty quickly. It's from Oregon State University, and it's called, the exhibition is called A Short History of the Seed and Nursery Catalog. And what it is just kind of a review of the history that I just gave, but then it also has a lot of scanned examples of the catalog. So, and some of them you can click on it, and then you get even more image, like the one from the 1830s from Grant Thorburn from New York City. You can click on that and get a whole bunch of new images so that you can see, like, you know, what vegetables he had. I didn't scan the entire catalog, but it has a bunch of really interesting pages from that catalog. And it's pretty fun to see what they had for sale.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's been available now for over 10 years or so. I published that in 2010. And it's funny because this year I've given several talks on the subject. I think just people are interested in seeds and seed catalogs this year. So I've just been getting a renewed interest in it.
How did that collection at OSU come to be? Like, is that like a particularly robust collection, and
No. I mean, it's about 2,000 catalogs or so, and it's not necessarily the most historically significant collection. I would say the Library of Congress and Smithsonian Institution, the National Agricultural Library, the Massachusetts Horticultural Society, the Pennsylvania Horticultural Society, they all have really large collections. And I think UC Davis has a collection. There's some regional ones from around the country. I'm pretty sure there's somewhere in Iowa that has collections. So, you know, it may be that your local university library has a collection. Also, the New York Botanical Garden and Cornell, I think, both have collections that are great. So some of them have digitized them. And so if you go somewhere like the Biodiversity Heritage Library or the Internet Archive, you can find amazing catalogs that have been digitized in full online. But the OSU collection was collected, I forget who it was that actually collected it, and I'm not even sure if it's known where they all came from, but they were almost thrown out at one point. But luckily a librarian saw their value and made sure that they didn't. And they were in about 2010 or so, all the contents of the collection was put online. And then I wrote this kind of introductory website as part of a project for my master's degree in library science.
Okay.
Yeah.
So some of those you feel like you can easily, can you like search by crop or name and the ones that are digitized, or it's not that
Easy. Some of them, not on the OSU collection, but you can do that in the in many of the catalogs on the Biodiversity Heritage Library, like or Internet Archive, like if you, or many of the other digital digitized museums sometimes put up there. And when you have the catalog there, often there is a little search thing where you can then search for the tomatoes or something like that.
Right.
And then the pages will come up that show the tomatoes. I don't think that there's definitely no universal search where you can search every historic catalog image. I mean, that would be awesome, but it's been hard because a lot of libraries didn't really catalog those catalogs. They were considered ephemera, so they were sort of stored in boxes rather than part of the whole collection. So it's now that people are starting to really digitize them.
It seems like, I mean, I think you seem like one person using them. Jules Janik Yeah. If I'm saying that right, seems like someone like, are there examples you can think of historians using these as, you know, resources to, whether it's like, you know, trace the history of celery or tomatoes or the different issues you brought up that maybe aren't even about the vegetables, but about what's being portrayed in them?
Yeah. Well, I haven't really read a critical study of like what's being portrayed in the catalogs. I mean, that just sort of occurred to me when I started talking about the people, and I was like, well, somebody could really do this because they would really notice some, you know, sociological things about America just from looking at the, you know, this kind of thing. But I would definitely say that there are some people that have used the catalogs in a historical sense. There's an article online by Harry Paris and Teresa Lust that traced the history of zucchini. And they used a couple of seed catalogs in their work to see what was available at certain times. I mean, you can, you know, there were definitely more and more seed catalogs as the 19th century progressed. And before that, it's kind of difficult to trace the history of variety names because very often, you know, there were not so many variety names before that. Some crops had variety names, but many of the varieties that people sold or had were just, you know, kind of a generic, these are the squash or something like that, or corn.
Yeah.
But they didn't necessarily have variety names. So,
yeah. You
know. But yeah.
I love that, the curious corn.
Yeah, I'm definitely, you know, he was from Scotland, so, you know, these things were curiosities to him, but, you know, of course they were different types of corn that they sold here, so, I mean, that were available here that there weren't in England or Scotland.
You mentioned, you know, there were a couple examples of catalogs that, like from one from Japan that was selling into the US. Are you aware of any such kind of collections of seed catalogs from other, you know, from Asia in particular? Japan comes to mind. I feel like I saw some, I can't remember where now, but there was something floating around recently on Instagram of these really neat old block prints from some, I can't remember if it was catalog or just art of different, you know, Asian vegetables from Japan, but
yeah, there's some really beautiful examples. There were some Japanese nurseries in the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century that sold to the United States. The one that comes to mind is the Yokohama nursery. And there are examples. I think maybe it's either the National Agricultural Library or the Smithsonian has some that are pictured on their website. They have some scans of digitized catalogs like the ones in my presentation. And I'm pretty sure that they actually have like a little collection of ones from Japan. So if you look on either of those, you can probably find some. And I know the Biodiversity Heritage Library has some Japanese catalogs. And it really is cool to see some of those photographs because these are really important historical photographs. Recently, Lane Selman communicated with two of her colleagues in Italy. And one of them from Lavantia seeds, Samuele Pellegrini, very kindly sent us some images of Italian seed catalogs that Lane put up on Instagram yesterday. And some of those are just wonderful to see because, you know, and I think, you know, it really is a part of their history too. And they're following in those footsteps.
Yeah.
And so are we all really who have worked with seeds that, you know, we're following, you know, the work of, you know, seed savers and farmers and also seed companies through the centuries. So it's kind of exciting to just sort of see what we're building upon in one way by looking at these catalogs.
Who is collecting catalogs now and what is the process of doing that? And, you know, there seems like there's just been, you know, for a long time, a lot of companies, and it seems like there's been this explosion of companies in the last 10 years. And then I think about Johnny's, you know, like, I feel like we're getting catalogs like four times a year. Like, is someone collecting all of those or what's happening now, you think?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I don't know. I mean, I know I have a bunch of them in my living room that I can't seem to get rid of. But, you know, and I just can't get rid of them for some reason. I just find them so interesting as reference material. I don't keep all, you know, if I get four per year, I definitely don't keep all of them. But yeah, I know that, you know, there are people that collect them, but I don't know, you know, I think Yeah, I don't know if there are libraries and museums that are actively collecting today's seed catalogs. And, you know, one of the things that I thought was really interesting about online catalogs was, I mean, that, you know, they can be updated at any moment. So unlike a printed catalog, they're not really an archive of, you know, what was there. Yeah, it's a snapshot in the same way, because, you know, you can update them at any moment to, you know, if you sell out of something. Or you no longer sell something, you can just remove it. Whereas, you know, the seed catalog is like this collection of that year. And it's kind of a little more permanent that way.
How much have you gotten into to looking at catalogs on the internet? And I'm not, is that internet archive that you're talking about, is that like an archive of internet websites? Like, I know there's, because there is something that you can access that's like these, like, back in time.
Yeah, the Wayback Machine. Yeah, that's different. Yeah, that's different. Okay. That's sort of like a snapshot of a particular, you know, date or whatever on the internet. Yeah. But that's, the Internet Archive is more, you know, I guess different archives and museums and libraries and stuff have actually archived books online. And so that's, you know, that's where you can see like a catalog from the 1800s or something like that. That's just one place. There's so many libraries and museums that have their own websites where they've digitized examples of historic catalogs.
So have you looked at using like the Wayback Machine, or is it just, you know, through memory? Like, I mean, that would be interesting to look at the evolution, you know, just in the last 20 years of what websites look like and the quality of pictures and the buttons to click. I mean, I don't know how fun it would be, but it would be interesting.
Well, I remember when I first worked at Shepherd's Garden Seeds, they didn't really, and, you know, they had recently, you know, gotten the website ordering system set up. And I had spent a couple of years in Connecticut there. This was after Renee Shepherd had sold Shepherd Seeds to White Flower Farm in Connecticut. And they had just gotten a system set up to take online orders, but I think they still had to somehow be manually put into the computer system. Because it didn't go directly into their order inventory system. So I think there's definitely been a lot of improvements.
Improvements, streamlining things.
First started,
I'm wondering, I mean, you brought some of these up a little bit, like if there are kind of like cycles that you've noticed in the history of like themes that like come up and then go away. Like, it seems like, you know, like the Victory Gardens, and then that kind of went away, and then again another war, and now with COVID we kind of, there was this like surge of like, I mean, yeah, people, some people were calling them Victory Gardens, and then I don't know if you caught on, then there was this kind of pushback of like, we shouldn't be calling them Victory Gardens because that was this time of war, and there was you know, racism and you know, all sorts of things that we shouldn't be you know, idealizing Victory Gardens so much. But I'm wondering, like, if you've noticed other kind of cycles, and that was fascinating, that one, the like for epicures, you know, and now we've got these, you know, Culinary Breeding Network and Rose 7 and all these people talking about breeding for flavor. And that's fascinating that in 19, what was that, 35 or 37 for epicures. Are there other kind of, you know, fads or cycles you've known that, like, you know, like waves where they happen and then go away and then come back?
Yeah, I think definitely there are. I mean, and that's, these catalogs really reflect the changing trends and the changing fashions over time. I think definitely when there's a crisis, people turn to food production, self-sufficiency. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, that's pretty much what we're seeing right now with the popularity of vegetable garden. Also, it's something to do in the pandemic, and it's a nice, fulfilling thing to do during the pandemic, as it was probably during the war as well. So, but, you know, it has a very practical use.
Right.
With your family. So, But also, yeah, that, for example, the sweet peas in the early 1900s, I mean, it was suddenly this craze for them, and then that died out. And then, of course, in the 1600s, when those first catalogs came out, there were a lot of tulip bulbs, and there was definitely a craze at the time for tulips. And then that kind of died down when people realized they weren't going to make their fortunes investing in tulips.
So what is, like, in, they're going to be historians in the future talking about, like, the 2020 kind of radicchio surge, the radicchio craze in the catalogs. That will be interesting.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm always interested in squash, so, you know, you can definitely see a lot more interest, like Lindsay was talking about before, in kabocha squash. That's something that a lot of people are familiar with. And yesterday, I know that Klaus brought up that it was a popular squash in Austria, and I believe it was introduced to Austria in the mid-1980s. The red Kuri or Hokkaido squash, as it's known over there. And I worked on a farm in Germany who had gotten in north of Frankfurt, Germany, and they'd gotten some seeds from Austria in about 1985 or so. And then it became very popular at the markets in Frankfurt, Germany as well. So I think it's interesting that Japanese squash, which really descended from South America, and it somehow got over to Japan, the Cucurbita maxima, in the late 19th century. And then the Tetsu Kabuto was hybridized, and it became a very popular vegetable in Brazil. So I think it's fascinating to track these travels of vegetables around the world.
Yeah, it seems like, I mean, you've been doing that with squash as the example you're talking about, but trying to combine using the catalogs and then also, people like culinary historians then looking at, you know, do you see them in the catalogs first? And then there's like this little bit of lag time, and then they start showing up in these recipes, and then all of a sudden they're like, well, of course we eat like red curry squash. It's from here. Like, no one even remembers that it wasn't there at some point. That's really interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. Yeah. And I mean, I think that I just kind of scratched the surface, really. I talked for half an hour about this, but I mean, there's so much more that you can discover in these catalogs. So I really hope that people that are interested take advantage of all the amazing things that are digitized right now. I mean, that's what made this research possible, really. Was how much is digitized now. So you can really find out all kinds of interesting things and see all kinds of historic photographs. And it's really worthwhile browsing these catalogs.
Yeah, I think that's exciting. And I think Lane has posted a link to the online exhibit. And I don't know if it's easy to do this elsewhere or where we would, but you've given us a great number of things to look at: the Biodiversity Heritage Library, Internet Archives, Smithsonian. It sounds like a lot of time can be burned looking through these old fascinating catalogs.
You certainly can burn a lot of time doing that. So
one thing I think we've got a little bit more time that I was thinking about, and I feel like comes up in the context of people talking about, we've lost all this diversity, and they'll say, oh, you look at these old catalogs and look at all these names. And wondering if you have any thoughts on, like, I don't know if I'm saying this right, but like name synonymy, like, you know, one catalog's calling it whatever, white marrow this, and the other ones are like, well, we want to pretend that it's different, so we're going to call it, you know, whatever, you know, like, where you end up, it looks like there's tons of diversity, but like, how do we know with common names that those aren't actually the same things? And then, you know, I guess maybe Seed Savers Exchange is a, you know, their I don't know if they're library staff, you would call them, or their historians are, you know, one place where people really try to delve into that and trace, you know, what's what and where did it come from. But yeah, just any thoughts on how useful or dangerous it is looking at these old things and thinking, wow, look at all this diversity and we've lost so much, but is that necessarily accurate?
Yeah, I think that's a really great question. And that's something something that's really hard to sort out, you know, unless you actually grow out all the different plants. Yeah. For example, in the Seed Savers Exchange, you know, I mean, a lot of these things are things that people got from their grandparents or whatever. So it might, you know, and they didn't know the original name for it. So they might have named it after their grandmother or something like that. And so it may turn out to be something that was commercially available a while ago, but, you know, you wouldn't know that unless you were able to grow out something very similar. And also, you know, you figure in the 19th century and even today, there's a lot of commercial pressure to for catalogs to produce something new every year and to come out with, you know, 50 or 100 new offerings and new varieties every year because they want to distinguish themselves from their competitors. And so, you know, there are definitely some catalogs that will rename things. And, you know, and that was done early on, way before. I don't know what the rules are for this kind of thing. I know in Europe they have very strict, you know, variety registries and things like that. I'm not really sure what things are like here in the United States in that regard, because I've never been involved with that. But yeah, certainly some companies rename things to make the name sound more enticing, or maybe the old name is, you know, something that wouldn't really be good to use anymore for one reason or another. So yeah, I think it's really hard to know, you know, especially like when, you know, hundreds of new sweet peas are offered or something in a particular catalog, a lot of those varieties ended up going away either because people weren't interested in them or because they weren't stable. Because, you know, for example, the company might've been under so much pressure to release a new variety that they might've just released something, but then, you know, you save the seeds from it and it turns out to be something completely different. So, yeah, some varieties are just really not that useful. And so they go away. Maybe not every single variety is worth preserving. But I think if you have too much standardization, the problem is then you lose all this diversity, some of which is really important. And that's why plant breeders are, you know, looking, using materials from other countries or wild varieties to breed into their plants for more diversity. But yeah, I think it's really hard to know, like, whether there was more diversity in some of these old catalogs. I mean, it is amazing what the selection of vegetables that they offered back then, though, were. I mean, you might think, okay, we're the only ones who, you know, we have four varieties of kale that we plant in our garden, but there were four varieties of kale back in the 1830s that people planted. So, you know, it is pretty amazing. And look at all those radishes, for example, that they had in
that was really
one catalog from the 1830s or so. And I mean, there's this wonderful album that I have in the background here. I'm showing it. It was published. It's an album of paintings by the French company Valmorin. And, you know, they show things like rainbow chard from, you know, the mid 19th century or so. You really might not have known that there was that available. We think that all these things that are new because they haven't been introduced for a number of years are something completely new, but actually it's something that was revived from older varieties.
I wonder if I mean, it would be interesting to know if any breeders ever try to use these, or germplasm curators. Like, I was just, you know, thinking how interesting that would be. You know, you can go into Grin and, you know, sometimes find these, you know, older varieties and then try to like triangulate and use some of these old catalogs and, okay, yeah, this really is what is in the catalog from, I don't, you know, some of those things, I don't know how old they are, but some of the things in Grin, but that seems like that would be a neat resource, and they should hire you to, you know, link the digitized seed catalogs to the accessions in the germplasm collection.
Yeah, that would be a big job. You might need a computer to do all that.
But, right.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm sure there are people working on some similar things, but there is no, you know, listing of every variety that there ever was that you can search and where you could have gotten it or anything like that.
Yeah, it is interesting. My understanding, which is not complete, of Europe being much more regulated in terms of varietal selection. And I mean, it seems like it's fairly Wild West here in the US, which is, you know, I think there's pros and cons to that. But seems like that would be an easier thing to do in Europe, where you're like, okay, here's the official list. Here, I don't feel like that would even be
possible. I'm hoping that they make sure that there's exceptions to the list, you know, because there's so many things that aren't necessarily named varieties, but there are local land races that people have produced for centuries and preserved in their gardens. And I know that also in Europe, there's definitely more interest in sort of local agrobiodiversity and conserving important historical varieties. And I know that some of that inspired this variety showcase of, you know, having festivals to celebrate historic varieties and traditional varieties in different areas. So,
it seems like the other thing that maybe comes out in some of these, you know, older catalogs and maybe not even so old are like the unique uses or methods of cultivating them. Like I'm thinking of the celery talk yesterday, you know, I'd never heard of this like mounding and forcing to get this, you know, blanched center of celery. And, you know, are there uses that have been lost or, you know, they're so regionalized, we don't even know about them, but maybe immigrants to the U.S. at one point were doing that and you can find that in these catalogs.
Yeah, and maybe not only in the catalogs, but older garden books and things like that. A lot of the seed company owners wrote gardening books, as I mentioned. Mm-hmm. Peter Henderson was one of them. And there are many other gardening books online where you can find all kinds of information. I know that there's tons of detailed information on how to grow melons in Northern Europe and stuff like that, which was a really popular thing for, you know, rich people to do, is, you know, have fresh melons. And so they employed gardeners to do all these elaborate tricks. Nice melons, even if it wasn't the perfect climate or time of year. So yeah, I think in England even, there's a lot of, you know, people, so there, you know, there were estates with really elaborate kitchen gardens that employed all kinds of gardeners. And so you can sometimes find digitized old books with all kinds of, you know, things like blanching celery or using those bell cloches or, you know, things like that, that we don't often do in our gardens here.
And like the, that USDA national, I don't even know if it's USDA, but the National Agricultural Library, Smithsonian and Biodiversity Heritage Library, or maybe places to start looking for that kind of historical gardening book.
Yeah, I think the Biodiversity Heritage, and Google Books is really a fantastic place as well. I've found all kinds of interesting things on Google Books. I remember for my squash presentation that I did and an article that I wrote, you know, I used Google Books and I was kind of wondering when the turban squash was first introduced. And the earliest one that I found on Google Books was some German catalog from 1779 or something like that.
Wow.
I certainly wouldn't have found that without Google Books. Somebody had actually scanned it. It was incredible. So
interesting.
Yeah.
Well, any parting thoughts on the history of catalogs and
not really. And I've been really, really honored to be part of this incredible event, and I hope that we can all meet in person in Portland next year.
That sounds good.
Fingers crossed.
Well, we're gonna, I think, take a short little break, and maybe people can stretch their legs, and then in just a few minutes we'll start up with our barley team. So thanks so much again. And this one will be available. People will be able to watch this. Okay, great. Cool.
Okay. Thanks, Jay.
Well, nice to see you. Thanks so much.
Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye.
I'm going to be on my vegetables. I'm going to chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
Okay, everybody. Well, that was a fascinating talk, and now we're gonna stay in Oregon with Team Barley that we've got with us here. They're gonna tell us about a really interesting sort of multifaceted participatory breeding project that they're doing, funded by OREI. So your tax dollars at work doing the kind of research that we want to see happening. And we have with us Pat Hayes, who longtime barley breeder at Oregon State University, Brigid Meints, who again, another person who's been active in the Student Organic Seed Symposium and now part of the Society of Organic Seed Professionals, Cristiana Vallejos and Jordyn Bunting, who's coming at it more from the food science side. And so, yeah, they're coming at this from a lot of neat angles. So we've got a not too short, but not too long video that they're gonna show to kind of give us an overview of their project. And then we'll come back and can ask specific questions we've got about their naked barley breeding project. Thanks for joining us, guys. And I think we'll cue up the video and turn our audio and videos off and then come back shortly for a question and answer.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brigid Meints, and I'm an assistant professor, senior research at Oregon State University, and I'm part of the barley breeding program. And today I'm here to talk to you about our organic barley breeding project. So this is a project that's funded by the USDA NIFA OREI, and it's part of a project called Developing Multi-Use Naked Barley for Organic Farming Systems Part 2. And OSU is the lead institution on the grant, but we also have collaborators at UC Davis, University of Minnesota, University of Wisconsin-Madison, Cornell, as well as some outreach collaborators, including at Grow NYC. For this grant, we have three different components: research, education, and outreach. For the research component, we're working on breeding naked barley, so that's barley that threshes free from the hull, for multiple end uses, which include food, feed, and malt. So we have a number of different projects that we're doing, including these field trials that I'll talk about a little bit more. We have a new breeding project that we're working on, and we have a number of different trials looking at disease resistance, other agronomic qualities, as well as end-use qualities, which we'll hear about a little bit more from our other speakers. For the education component, we're working with K-12 students to teach them about agriculture, genetics, nutrition, math, using barley as an example. For the outreach component, as I mentioned, we work with Grow NYC, and we've got barley at their green market stand. We also work with Lane Selman at the Culinary Breeding Network to do events like this, as well as other tastings and outreach types of things, including our newly released barley zine, which is on our website and social media, so check that out. Later in the video, you'll be hearing from two graduate students on the project who are at Oregon State University, Cristiana Vallejos and Jordyn Bunting, about their projects. We'll also be hearing from Dr. Patrick Hayes, who is the leader of the barley breeding program at OSU, and we'll be talking about one of our favorite end uses of naked barley, roasted barley tea. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the trial that I'm standing in. So this is the fall regional trial that each of the cooperators on the grant has planted. And we're looking at a number of different traits with this trial, including agronomic qualities such as plant height, heading date, lodging, yield, as well as some post-harvest traits. And then there are a number of traits that are really crucial, especially when breeding for organic systems. So weeds are a huge problem for organic growers. And so one of the things that we can measure is weed compatibility. And so we have a number of traits that we look at to do that, including at this stage, early plant height. And you can see that there are differences, pretty significant differences at this stage between these two plots. We can look at early vigor. So later in the season, we'll measure percent weeds, percent barley, and percent open ground in the plots to see which barley genotypes compete better against the weeds than others. Another trait that's really important for organic agriculture is disease resistance. So we have a lot of different fungal diseases that infect the barley in the Willamette Valley. And one that's especially important for organic growers is smut. So we have two types of smut, loose smut and covered smut. And those are especially problematic for organic growers because conventional growers have a really effective seed treatment that they can use. And so breeders have stopped breeding for resistance to these diseases. However, because they are seed-borne, they can be especially problematic for organic growers because they can persist in the seed for a long time. And so we have a project going on right now in the greenhouse where we're screening a bunch of different barley genotypes to look for smut resistance, and then we can start breeding new varieties using those lines of parents.
Hi everyone, my name is Cristiana. I'm a graduate student with the Barley program, and my research focuses on developing selection tools for breeding naked barley. So one of the end uses for this project is malt. And a lot of the research surrounding malt is really focused on old barley rather than naked barley. And so our goal is to kind of see where naked barley fits in the world of malting. And so we know that oftentimes naked barley needs a modified steeping and germination protocols. And so one tool that we are using is called the Chapon test. And with the Chapon test, we are steeping barley in tea walls. We then subsample the barley at different time periods within the steeping process and cut those kernels in half. And then we visually score them on a scale of 0 to 4, and where 0 is not hydrated at all and 4 is fully hydrated. And so then we can calculate what's called the steeping index. And this index gives us a really good way to gauge the quality of the hydration of the endosperm of the barley for these different steeping protocols.
Hi, my name is Jordyn. I am a food science graduate student here at Oregon State, and I work with the Barley Breeding Program to help research food quality and functionality as it applies to barley. And so the background behind that, despite barley being the fourth most produced crop worldwide, it has such a small market for food that there's no really like set specifications for how to use barley in a food product. So we are trying to expand on that to make it more analogous to like wheat, where there's a hard, soft, red, white, winter, spring type of system, to where if I told a baker this is a hard red spring variety, they're probably gonna know that it's good for bread baking applications and maybe not put it in a pastry. So we're kind of using that as a rough model of what we wanna see the future of barley. What food quality is, these are the traits of the grain that are relevant to how it could perform in a food product. And these are traits that go beyond disease resistance and yield. So traits like the fiber content, specifically beta-glucan, the starch profile, if it's like a normal starch profile, if it's waxy, the hardness of the grain, the susceptibility to sprouting, how well the grain threshes off the hull. Since I deal with naked varieties, threshability is very important. And so the last section I study is functionality tests. And so going beyond quality tests, this is more directly related to cooking and baking performance types of tests. And these tests have a quantifiable outcome to where it will let me know how a variety may perform, like example in a bread application or a pastry application. Some examples of these tests are water absorption of the flour, batter flow, the yield of like whole grain cooking. If I were to mix flour into like a wheat-based dough, how would those varieties affect like the volume, the texture of the bread, and the staling rate, as well as like paste viscosity, so like cooking up a suspension of the flour, similar to how you would like polenta on a stovetop. And then I have some visual examples of what these types of tests are. And so the paste viscosity, you can see the two different varieties. The one has a much more standing upright sort of like firmer gel structure, while the other is more liquidy. And despite these being barley, they're gonna have two very different mouthfeels and performance in a product. And then in this setup with batter flow, it looks kind of like a Neapolitan organization of barley. You have a purple variety, a white variety, and black variety, and you can see their how far they flow is dramatically different. And so you can't just assume that all barley is going to perform the same. And so the overall goal of all this research is to put all these results together, which is to develop a specification framework of relating these quality and functionality tests to ultimately predict how a given variety of barley is going to perform in a product. And hopefully these tests can shed some light on if a variety is better off in a bread application or maybe being blended into like a noodle formulation, as well as pastry applications.
Hi, I'm Pat Hayes with the Oregon Barley Project, and I'd like to tell you about my favorite beverage, which is roasted barley tea. So roasted barley tea is made from, as you'd think, roasted barley. And it's a beverage that is tasty, refreshing, and has no caffeine, no alcohol. So if you'd like that little afternoon pickup without the buzz, why think about a chilled roasted barley tea. So it may seem new to us, but roasted barley tea is an ancient beverage, and it's been popular in Asia probably since the domestication of barley around 10,000 years ago. And you can see here a sampling of some of the different products that are available, and you can find them in Asian food markets. Japan, the roasted barley tea is known as mugi cha, pardon my pronunciation, and it comes in a number of forms. You can get a bulk product, or you can also get a roasted barley tea that's already ground in a tea bag. Here in our research program, we asked the question, could we taste differences between the roasts of different naked barleys? And to that end, we purchased a coffee roaster from Japan that is used in Japan at the Roasted Barley Tea Institute to assess different roasts. And we made roasts from our different varieties of naked barley. And we really couldn't pick up that big of a difference in sensory between the different varieties that we have or with the different roasts that we developed. But interestingly, we did find a difference in flavor between the roasts that we made and the commercially available roasts. So those that tasted preferred our own, and but I think it's very much a matter of taste. So the to prepare roasted barley tea, you can go a couple of routes. This is using a cold brew system, and so that's about 25 grams of roasted barley per liter, and you just let that sit overnight. You can do a much simpler version of that by putting about the same amount of roasted barley in a jar with same amount of water, and then let that sit overnight. The roasted barley settles out to the bottom, so you're able to just pour off the top without having to use a colander. The other way to make a hot beverage, and a real simple one, is to use a French press, and that's what we have here. And the hot beverage is something that is just delightful in the wintertime. And again, no caffeine in this case, so if you'd like just that little something, the hot roasted barley tea might be the thing for you. Well, cheers, and look forward to sharing a boogie chow with you sooner than later.
Thanks everybody for tuning in to Organic Barley. If you would like to learn more, we do have some social media pages. So you can find us at Naked Barley on Instagram, at Multi-Use Naked Barley on Facebook. And we have a couple websites. We have barleyworld.org, and we also have an eOrganic website. You can just Google eOrganic and barley. And then if you'd like to learn more about some of the different projects that we're working on, we're excited to be hosting, in collaboration with some other folks, a Grains Week, which will be taking place May 3rd through the 7th. So keep your eyes out for more information about that. Thank you.
Okay, everybody. Feel free to join us back on. All right, we've got Jordyn live from the lab. Thanks everybody for joining us. We'll see if we get some more questions coming in. I had a few right off the bat. I think I have some ideas, but does somebody want to tell us why naked barley? What's wrong with hulls?
Sure. So hulled barley is great. I mean, it's an ancient grain, been around for 10,000 years. Naked barley has actually been around for, I think, about 8,500. So it doesn't come too far after hulled barley. And hulled barley does have some advantages for some of the end uses that we're talking about. So for malting, it can be beneficial. Sorry about that. And for feed, it can be beneficial. But if you want to eat barley, that hull is insoluble fiber. It's very papery and not very palatable. And so in order to eat barley that has a hull on it, it's typically pearled. And that pearling process, which is a physical abrasion process, also removes some of the bran and the germ. And so it's no longer a whole grain. And so in terms of food end uses, we're all about naked barley. And then we thought, why not, you know, go naked all the way and breed some malting barley that's also naked. There are some advantages to using naked barley for malting, brewing, and distilling. That hull doesn't contribute to the potential alcohol yield. So we actually see a higher what's called malt extract in naked barley. And then the hull for animal feed, for animals that have monogastric systems, they don't digest the cellulose of the hull. And so for swine and poultry, actually a naked barley can be beneficial.
I haven't done a lot of brewing, but am I right that when you, Cristiana, you mentioned it, I can't remember what it's called, but when you like are letting the mash drain, like do the hulls play a part in that when normally? So how does that differ if you have hullless? Would you like have to change your process of brewing a little?
Yeah, so those hulls do act as like a filtration device during the lautering step. And so technology like mashing filters can be super useful for naked barley because you don't need the hulls for mash filters. We are working on studies comparing mash filters and water tuns using either rice hulls as an adjunct or covered and naked barley blends. So yeah, those hulls are super important in most brewing systems that use those water tuns, but with different technologies, we can use naked barley efficiently.
Okay. I had a question too about planting dates. That was like recently filmed. Is that true? You out in the field? So that's possible in west of the Cascades, but your other collaborators in colder places, are they planting now, or like is barley planted as a winter grain that vernalizes and goes through the winter, or is it spring planted typically, or are there options there?
Yeah, so you can have both winter and spring barley, as well as what are called facultative types. And so here in Oregon for the winter barleys, we typically plant in mid-October. So I think that trial was planted October 16th or so. And our collaborators in the Midwest and Northeast also do plant the winter barley trials. However, they often see pretty heavy winter kill. And so sometimes that will be complete trial failure. But especially in the Northeast at the Ithaca location, they do tend to see some differential winter survival. And so different varieties do have different levels of winter hardiness. We also have spring nurseries. So those are typically planted between March and April, depending on where you're located. And then the facultative types, so those types do have winter hardiness. But they don't have a vernalization requirement. So they can be planted in the fall or the spring.
So there are some varieties that you have to plant as winter because they have to get vernalized. Okay.
Correct. So yeah, if you were to plant those in the spring, they would just produce vegetative material and never transition to flowering.
Okay. Can you guys tell us some about how you're involving K through 12. That's to me was a really exciting part of the project that you guys are doing.
Yeah.
Like you're developing education.
Talk about that, because actually... that's what you're super jazzed about. You're muted.
Pat's gonna talk about that? All right.
Yeah. So, absolutely jazzed about it, as Brigid put it, because we try to get everybody into barley. And so it's real easy for adults to be thinking about barley in terms of barley foods or barley beverages and so forth. And so barley is also just an outstanding vehicle for, sharing ideas and perspectives on genetics and plant breeding. And we have a graduate student in our group, Margaret Halstead, who's been working on developing lesson plans. And we have a couple of those now that are posted at the Barley World. And so one of the tabs is education. And there are units out there. There's one just starting out for, like a first grade level. And then there's an intermediate, and then there's an eighth grade level. And then we also carry on into the university environment. And so I teach a course in plant genetics, and sometimes on the course evaluations, it'll say, wow, really nice class on barley genetics. We try not to brainwash too much on that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so for that, we also have focused some of the lessons around a population or blend that we call the Oregon Naked Barley Blend. And that is actually available in 100 gram packets to anyone who's interested in growing it. And so you can learn more at, I think it's barleyworld.org/ONBB. And that has a link to my email address where you can request a 100 gram packet. And that is a blend that contains 753 pure lines naked barley, all naked, but then a range of other phenotypes. So it has both springs and winters, different colored types, talls and shorts, twos and six rows. And so we've used that as a vehicle for some of these lesson plans. And we have at all the locations around the country where the grant is, we've been working with mostly middle school classrooms to do selection exercises. They've grown it out in their school gardens. And so that's been really fun as a tool for that. But also, we've sent out, dozens and dozens of kilos of the seed to just home gardeners, farmers, anyone who's interested around the country. And the fun thing about this blend is that you can grow it as a blend. and sort of watch it change over time as it adapts to your individual system. But you can also select, you know, a single head out of there and then increase that, and suddenly you have your own unique variety. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, we really encourage people to reach out to us if they're interested in planting that. And then, you know, we'd love to hear your feedback if you do grow that blend, how it does for you, you know, if you've made any selections, if you've harvested your little plot and milled it, yeah, made it into a single loaf of bread.
Well, that's very cool. You guys are like training the next generation of Novik trial managers in all these different places. That's great. The kids must, you know, get a sense of being part of this larger network of other kids growing them out around the country. That's really cool part of the project.
Well, and one of our local schools that we've worked with is the Springfield Public Schools. And so we'd go through the exercise with the Oregon Naked Barley blend that Brigid mentioned. And then there'd be barley pancakes. And a lot of kids were coming back for seconds.
Yeah. Jordyn, I had a grain food science question, maybe. Number one, that was pretty impressive visual there of like the, what's it called, the extensibility or what's causing that? And then my other question is, I've been geeking out pretty heavily on like the waxy gene and all these different grains, and I saw a reference that exists in barley and was wondering, is that a good thing, bad thing? Do you guys ever work with that? Like, how would that be used in barley?
Yeah, so both questions you just asked kind of tie in together. Usually the big differences that you'll see with the batter flow is usually because of the beta-glucan content. Typically higher varieties or higher beta-glucan varieties, they have shorter batter flows just because they absorb so much water. Beta-glucan can absorb a lot of water. But then in order, a way of breeding high beta-glucan is to select for the waxy locus. And so typically the highest varieties of beta-glucan that I deal with are often waxy starch as well. And then waxy starch alone also has the capacity to absorb a lot of water. And so you tend to see these things at the same time. So in general, when I have a waxy type, I'm pretty confident that it has high beta-glucan and it's gonna absorb a lot of water. And so I think that's like the main differences that I see in barley is the starch type and the beta-glucan. And so I guess down the road, if you were like formulating like a pancake, maybe a normal starch and modest beta-glucan might be better for that because the batter will be more runny. Or if you had a waxy type, maybe it is better, but you just have to add more water to account for that starch type and beta-glucan content.
And in brewing or distilling, is one more desired than another? I know a guy who's a sorghum breeder that was saying that in China they make a distilled spirit from, and they want waxy sorghum because they get like a higher, I don't know if they're more fermentable sugars or that's easier, the amylopectin for, I don't know enough of the science there, but like why would you want, for brewing, would you want more amylopectin versus amylose?
Yeah, for the brewing aspect, I can't. Yeah, it would be a random guess. I can't even think why they would do that.
Yeah.
I'm not sure on that.
Yeah.
Sort of one thing to just follow up on that concept. One thing on the idea of the waxy and the beta-glucan would be that the beta-glucan is, you know, the dieter's delight and it's the brewer's bane. And so if you up your beta-glucan in the waxy, then that's going to potentially lead to even further filtration issues than in the resulting alcohol. But other than that, you know, I'm sure there's some literature on using waxies. Does that resonate at all, Bridget, in anything you've reviewed?
Not really. So We are, as Cristiana mentioned, doing this hydration index test on 384 naked barleys that are part of our diversity panel. And a subset of those do have waxy starch. And just sort of my initial impressions from doing that, the waxy types seem to hydrate very rapidly. It's hard to know if that is, at this point, we can't really identify whether that's related to the waxy type or if that's related to, most of the waxy lines come out of a single breeding program for this trial. And so, we need to do more exploration into whether those waxy types are gonna be useful for brewing. But as Pat said, waxy types always have higher levels of beta-glucan, and so that's problematic, but as far as I know, malting barley has just been bred with normal starch, and so there hasn't been a lot of research done on that.
Okay, well, thanks for indulging my amateur grain geekery there.
I heard a rumor you're working with a little koji there too, Jay, huh?
Yeah, I've been doing some koji. I've made some tempeh recently that had some barley in it. I think I've got some miso going right now, barley lentil. obviously a total wormhole when I think you guys are deep in with all of this stuff.
Jordyn's been working on that, and I don't think we've mentioned this yet, but we did put out a barley zine about a year ago at this point, and it does have a recipe in there that Jordyn developed for a barley chickpea tempeh, and that zine is available on barleyworld.org or your eOrganic site, or Lane is selling hard copies through her Etsy site. So
great.
Pretty fun. There are some interesting recipes in there, and
ordering one after we get off.
Nice. Well,
thanks so much, guys. It's great to see you in Zoom world. Hope to get to see you before too long in the real world. And we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll get into some basics of breeding with Organic Seed Alliance. So you guys have a good rest of the day.
Thanks,
take care.
Jay. Thanks, bye-bye. Lane. Thanks, Abba.
I'm going to be around my vegetables. I'm going to chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
All right, everybody, the marathon continues here live. We're going out to the West Coast where we've got our friends from Organic Seed Alliance joining us from multiple locations, I'm assuming. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Nice to see you all.
Hey, Trey. Nice to see you.
Yeah. So these guys did a great intro yesterday to seed saving, and today they're gonna continue on that track, but beyond seed saving, to get into some basics of breeding for folks that are interested and intrigued and inspired by all of this breeding talk to make that part of their practice. So I believe you guys have about another hour or so. I think probably won't be that whole time, your presentations, and then we'll take, if we're gonna do it like you guys did yesterday, where you'll each kind of do a section and then we can have questions partway through. Okay, yep. Great. So I think we'll jump right into that. It's not a video, it's live. So as you guys have questions, go ahead and type them in, viewers, to the YouTube chat, and then we'll take a little pause between each presenter and have some time for questions. And then hopefully the next speaker will just keep following up on that logical progression of things. So you're going to go first, Laurie?
Sounds good. No, actually, Micaela is going to start us off. All right. I'm going to go second, and Jared will finish us up.
Perfect. All right.
All right. Thank you, Jay. Thanks for inviting us back again. We're here from Organic Seed Alliance. Organic Seed Alliance is a nonprofit organization. We're national in scope, but our work is really focused on developing regional seed systems, partnering with nonprofits, universities, and farmers across the U.S. But really, when it comes to saving seed and perhaps even more breeding your own varieties, your regional context is very relevant to both the biology and the values of your seed crop and the needs for your farm. So I'm Micaela Colley, Organic Seed Alliance's Program Director, and I'm joined here today with Jared Zystro, OSA's Research and Education Associate or Assistant Director, and Laurie McKenzie, OSA's Research and Education Northwest Associate. We also have advocacy programs that address impacts in consolidation and contamination in the seed industry in particular, and policies that foster healthy seed systems. So today we're just going to dive right in, talk a little bit more about how to breed your own varieties. Hopefully most of you saw the seed saving yesterday. Yep, there we go. So in a nutshell, when you think about taking on a breeding project, there's a little bit of foresight and planning can go a long way. And it starts out by thinking about what you want to breed, what crop is going to be worthy enough to you to warrant all of your time and investment of energy into breeding. And what are your breeding goals? What do you want to get out of it? Plant breeding is a combination of art and science, and often the goals you start out with may not be the goals that you end up with at the end of a process, but putting a little bit of planning and forethought into the breeding project from the beginning can certainly inform your pathway as you go along. We recommend starting with variety trials to really get to know what's out there and starting with the best material for your breeding project. And then, of course, breeding itself is essentially an iterative process of making crosses and selecting the best plants. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that first initial starting of a breeding project, and then Jared and Laurie are going to dive a little further into the how-to of crossing and selecting varieties or plants for a new variety. So choosing the right crop, it's worth asking yourself the important question of, is it important to you? And that sounds pretty obvious, but keep in mind, a breeding project can take many, many years to complete, and it may never end. Once you start working with a crop, often a variety may come out of it that is relevant and worthy of planting and using, but you may continue working with that crop into the future, perhaps even your whole lifetime. So finding a crop that not only resonates you, but has some importance, perhaps brings value to your farm, whether it has culinary qualities that are important to you, a heritage crop that you have a personal connection with is a relationship building opportunity that you may co-evolve with this crop over time and keep carrying forth a legacy that our seed savers who really were plant breeders from our past initiated. Do you love it? You know, do you want to eat it? Do you want to evaluate what it tastes like? Do you love what it looks like? Laurie McKenzie put this photograph in this slide, I know, because this is one of her favorite crops. And every time she slices open a carrot, she does this little dance. And that's an indicator that she's working with a crop that she's going to pay attention to, right? And then, of course, you have to also ask yourself, can you save seed of this crop in your climate? That doesn't mean that you have to be able to produce high quality commercial seed in order to breed a crop, but how challenging is it to achieve reproductive success? Are you going to need to put it under a cage in order to get enough heat units to get it to make seed in your climate? Are you going to have to protect it in the fall from rain? Will it overwinter in the field? Or are you going to have to make some extra effort to carry a biennial forward from year to year? And can you make progress on what you want? You know, I once asked a farmer what he wanted in a kale breeding project. And he said, basically, I want a kale that I don't have to bend over and pick. Well, and so that farmer in particular crossed the kale with a Brussels sprout, which is the same species, in order to get that high stature. That's something achievable if you're creative enough. But when you think about what your goals are, think about how realistic it is and how much effort it's going to get to the point that you want and then that your dream and your vision is for this breeding project. And are you going to be handling a self-pollinated or cross-pollinated crop? And what are the implications of that in terms of working into your farming system? Are you also growing that crop as a production crop or as a food crop on your farm, in which case you have to make sure that you're not crossing it with your breeding project. And of course, that's perhaps has different implications, whether it's an annual or biennial. So starting with breeding goals, there's a list of a few common breeding goals that are prioritized, particularly for organic systems, regional adaptation. We want vigorous crops that withstand pests and disease and weeds. We want robustness in our crops. All of these things may feel somewhat obvious that we all want all of these qualities in all of our crops, but starting out with an articulation of your breeding goals will help you not only in establishing your evaluation of variety trials in order to find the best material to start with, but also honing in on what your selection criteria is going to be. And these breeding goals can have a different weighted prioritization. Of course, we all want disease resistance, but perhaps your main goal is to breed a spinach that tastes better than any spinach you've ever eaten before. One of my breeding mentors told me breeding is like juggling balls. You can only throw so many balls up in the air and keep them at once. So you're going to be identifying what those traits are that you're going to prioritize when you finally make the decisions in the field of which plants have the best combination of qualities to carry forth from one generation to the next. So starting with trials, and certainly there's a lot of breeding projects that have started by seeing something beautiful in the field and saving seed from it, or saving seed from a hybrid and all of a sudden the next generation segregated and had a diversity of qualities, and you start saving seed and now you're off on a breeding project. But we do advocate starting with variety trials, because once you've identified your crop and your goals, you will save yourself years of effort if you start with something that already has the greatest combination of those quality traits to start with. So think about it like, okay, so I'm going to just start saving seed from this spinach plant using the last example. And I want a spinach that is really, really dark green. So I start saving seed from the darkest green ones. Well, lo and behold, one day I try another spinach. I look at a spinach trial and I see something that's already five times as dark as my spinach was to start with. If I'd started with that, I would have saved myself those 5 years of selection. And that's what every year of farming is one more opportunity for selection. So sourcing as much diversity within that crop, recommendations from seed catalogs or other farmers of things that already have some of those qualities you're looking for in your breeding goals, and then evaluating that diversity before you pick which seed sources to start with for making a new cross or for beginning your selection process. When you do a variety trial, there are a few basic principles to follow. You want to, of course, as I said, source as many varieties that fit the description of your end goal for your breeding project as possible, but then plant them on your farm systematically so that the varieties that you're growing, you are putting them all under as uniform of a field environment as possible, given the fact that our farms are very diverse in microclimates and soil conditions. Keeping the uniformity of the field condition as much as possible uniform will ensure that when you evaluate the quality of those different varieties, what you're seeing is a genetic component of that variety's performance and not the chance that it was planted in one of the best spots in the field. By the same principle, you also want to randomize the order that you're planting these varieties and replicate those varieties a few times, two times at least, but more is better across the field. So if one does look really good or one does look really bad, one of the varieties, you have, essentially a couple of chances to perform across that environment, and you can better tease out whether or not it performed well because of the environment or because of the genetics. We do have a toolkit on our website that has a lot of guidance on how to do trials, but also some resources for tracking your variety trials in the field and evaluating, analyzing the results of your trial. With that, I'm going to break if we have a question or two and pass the baton to my colleague, Jared. And if there's no questions, we can save that to the end, Jay.
I think we'll do that. I'm not seeing any questions quite yet.
Okay, we're going to dive in deeper and probably have more meat for questions in a bit here. So I've unshared my screen. Go ahead, Jared.
Okay, it's actually me. I'm going to...
Right, the other Jared.
Laurie. Sneak in here. It's all right. I don't mind being confused with Jared. He's pretty cool. All right. Okay. Can you all see the screen, Micaela and Jared? Okay, great. So I'm just gonna dive a little bit deeper into selection, which is the next sort of step once you've decided what you wanna do and really committed to it. This is a little bit more of the how-to. The first thing I wanna make sure that everybody is clear on is that when you make selections, you're generally selecting on what it looks like. We're gonna talk about other ways to do that and ways to make that the most effective, but you're selecting, unless you're doing other types of evaluations, you're selecting based on the phenotype. Phenotype is what the plant looks like. And that's a combination of its genetic makeup and its response to the environment. So you can have the same genetic makeup, and it might look different in one place versus another. Michaela's right, that carrot phenotype is my favorite. And every time I cut those carrots open, it's been 5 years since I first got introduced to that carrot phenotype. And I still do the happy dance every time. It's stunning. But those carrots look different, a little bit different when they're grown down in our winter nursery in Southern California than they do up here in Washington. So part of that is because they respond to the different environments a little bit differently. And so that genetic makeup is not necessarily fully expressed in what you're seeing in the plant. And some of the traits within that genetic makeup are, sometimes the trait is really simple and it's controlled by one or two genes. And those are generally ones that you see. And then there are traits that are really called, they're called polygenic or complex. And that means there's multiple genes that interact and contribute to that trait being expressed. Those tend to be, have more of that environmental interaction component. So they're a little bit harder to select for, but we'll talk about how to do that. And this is actually a cabbage breeding project that we have been involved with for a long time here on the research farm. And I've only seen this once. I saw this phenomenon. I thought, well, isn't that cool? Wouldn't it be great for seed production if that was heritable? But I knew enough to think that probably it wasn't, and that probably it's more of an environmental response than actually due to some genetics. So when you're doing selection, it basically means you're either selecting plants that you like and you want to move forward with, or you're selecting plants that you don't like and you want to get rid of them and not have their genetics move forward or contribute to moving your population forward. So some plants may look superior, and that may be because they do have a better genetic combination. They're more genetically robust, but it may also be that there's something about that little microclimate in the field where they are, where maybe they just got a little extra compost when you were spreading compost, or maybe they're in a slightly lower spot and they got more irrigation, or, I mean, that can work both ways. You know, that can make a plant look really good and it can make a plant look really bad. So that's just something you want to keep in mind. You don't want to keep seeds or genetics from plants that don't do well. So you want to take those out, and you want to take them out before anything pollinates if possible. We'll come back to that as well. And you might just take some out because they don't match what you're going for. They don't match your varietal type or your idiotype. And you can do that at a lot of different stages. Down here on the left, this is a kale breeding project that we've been doing with Nash's Organic Produce for a number of years. And you can see in here, see this little seedling right here is green. What we want are these purple seedlings. So we can actually do selection at this phase when we're just in the greenhouse growing our transplants. We actually didn't plant any of these for our breeding project because we're trying to get rid of these green ones in the population. So here are a few things we're going to talk about. Here are those carrots that I love. We talked about this single gene versus polygenic or complex traits. So these are things that are more challenging to select for. The single gene traits are easier to select for. These tend to be things like texture, color, texture meaning like leaf color, if you have a savoid or a flat. Habit can be a fairly simple gene thing to select for. So like determinate, indeterminate, upright, prostrate, those kind of things. If you see variation for a trait of interest within the population that you're looking at, that's a sign that you can make progress on that trait. If you see one plant out of 100 that has this trait that you like, that may or may not work out for you. But the more you see variation across the population, all the plants you're looking at in these traits of interest, that's a sign that there's the genetic opportunity to make progress. That said, there are some traits that are not heritable. That goes back to that environmental interaction and expression. So it can also, if you want to dive a layer deeper and you know about dominant versus recessive genes and traits, dominant traits are considered not heritable because they can be masking a recessive trait. If remember that green and purple kale we just looked at, the green is a recessive. So that means if I take those out of the population, they're gone. But those purples could be either dominant purple or dominant recessive and still hiding a green. So I'm not necessarily getting rid of all the greens because I don't know if there's still greens hiding in those purple genes. Jared is going to walk you through an example of how to do a family selection, which is just a way to select from related plants. And that's a way to sort of maximize the genetic expression and give you opportunity to make more progress and faster progress based on the genetics that are expressing within the population. And you're more likely to see, if you have recessive traits like that green in the kale, you're more likely to see those in your population if you do some sort of family or related selection. So a few more things to keep in mind when you're managing your selection. You want to stay very attentive to isolation distances. So this means managing cross-pollination, and that could be with other crops in your garden. Like Micaela mentioned, if you have something else that you might be growing that might be either going to seed or producing fruit, like a tomato or
squash or a pepper. Squash and pepper are more likely to outcross and cross-pollinate. What's also in your neighbor's garden or farm? And do you have any compatible weeds or volunteers coming up from your previous production? On the bottom here, you'll see these are pollination cages that we use for our carrot breeding and our carrot seed production. We have Queen Anne's lace, as well as wanting to grow out seed of multiple different breeding populations. So this is how we manage that isolation. We have to manage pollinators in these cages. This is not something I expect you're going to be doing in your garden, but you can build these out of PVC pipe or you know, wood or things that you have around. And there's different materials you can use if you really want to get into it and play with isolation. You also want to be really careful of cleaning any seed cleaning equipment. If you are producing seed for your own use or commercial use, and you're producing breeding seed or breeding project seed, make sure that you're using an air compressor, that you're really getting everything out and you're not mixing up your seed. So this is a sort of visual example of how selection is effective. So Jared made this nice example here. Like anything, most anything in nature exists on a bell curve. So let's see, this is the parental population that we're gonna select from over here on the left-hand side, less desirable. Over here on the right-hand side, we're gonna say these are the plants that we want. The harder you select, the fewer plants you select from in the bell curve, the more progress you're gonna make. So when we grow these seeds out the next year, we've moved this bell curve. We've moved what the average plant looks like in the direction of the suite of traits that we are aiming to achieve. So the only thing here is you need to keep in mind population size. If you're working with strongly cross-pollinated crops, you're gonna need larger population sizes. So if you wanna do a really intense selection, you're gonna need a big field to select out of. And this is, again, just when to select. You can select a lot, multiple times through seedling stage, through the seed stage, which if you are looking for, it's an important thing to consider is how good of a seed producer it is, especially if you are aiming to create a new variety that you hope to commercialize or you want to share widely. It's really nice to have something that's a strong seed producer. It's going to be really important for any commercial seed company that's going to pick it up. And also make sure you're aware of and identifying the key times to evaluate your traits of interest. So if you're really interested in, you know, early maturity, make sure you're getting out there and also looking at flowering time and trying to find the times that will help you make the best progress on those traits of interest. And then selection made prior to pollination is more effective than selection made after pollination. And I'm gonna show you some pictures that are maybe a little more interesting. We're gonna come back to that in just a second. So since we're talking about culinary quality, I wanted to just really hone in on some of the things that we do to incorporate culinary quality into our breeding work and things that you can easily do as well. So do taste tests and do them before pollination if you can. And also consider both raw and cooked evaluations depending on what crop you're working with, and go back to remnant seed if possible after your tasting is done. This is going to be really important for things like corn, where you are unable to evaluate before you get any pollination. So here's Micaela in our sweet corn breeding patch. We go through and we taste all the ears from the families that look really good. And then we actually go back to seed that we use to plant those plants, and we take that seed and we use that for our further breeding, because this corn could have been pollinated by other corn plants in the patch that were too late or didn't taste good or had qualities we didn't like. And so we don't want that pollen to move forward. This is a project that we're doing with some regional farmers here in Washington who are from the Oaxaca area of Mexico and are looking for dry corn varieties that they can grow and mature early enough here in our Pacific Northwest climate. So this is one that where we're doing the evaluations cooked. We're nixtamalizing and working with this Oaxacan farmer, Nalita, who's doing the tasting evaluations. And then we go back and we grow out new corn the following year and make crosses with the ones that did best. This is purple sprouting broccoli down here in the corner. This is one where you can actually cut the head off and the sprouts will continue to come up and produce seed for you. Spinach, you can definitely eat both at a baby stage and a larger bunching stage. This is my adorable F1 son helping with some tasting evaluations in the field. So some crops that are meant to be cooked, you can actually still get a good sense of flavor profile when they're raw. The carrots, we actually dig up and then we cut the tips off and we taste them. This allows us to do a flavor evaluation. Here's Micaela doing a flavor evaluation on some of our winter nursery roots, but it also gives us a chance to select the internal color, which is important to us as well. And then up here is a cabbage. We do cabbage breeding here at OSA. And the thing that I want to point out here is this is the growing tip right here. This is the most important part. If you're going to leave the head on the stalk, you can actually cut off all of this tissue around and use it for tasting evaluation. We've done that a lot when we dig up plants and move them for seed production. I have been told you can actually also cut the entire head off, but I've actually never had the confidence and the wherewithal to try that because I find it slightly terrifying for seed production, but I've heard it's really effective. So with that, I am actually going to hand it off to Jared, unless there are any pressing questions.
I'm not seeing any pressing questions from folks yet. Are we going to talk about population sizes?
We covered population size a little more in the seed saving side of things. And
okay,
you know what Laurie said in terms of balancing population size with selection intensity is every crop's going to have its own requirements, both in terms of, you know, the size of the population. I would certainly recommend anyone that's getting into seed saving or plant breeding, take a look. There's a lot of different places to look, but our seed saving guide that we have that you can download for free on our website has a table that includes recommended population sizes. If you look at those, then balance that with how many different traits you're trying to improve and how hard you think it's going to be to find plants that fit all those traits, you can kind of multiply and say, oh boy, I need a big population and I need to have a lot of plants to be able to find ones that are good. So I need to start with, you know, a large field. Or in contrast, you know, this is a plant that requires relatively few plants to be able to keep the population healthy, so I can end with relatively few plants and I don't need to do a lot of improvement. There's a few simply inherited traits or maybe even one simply inherited trait that I want to improve, so I can start with a small patch, select a little bit, and still have enough seed to go by. So the population size that you're starting with and that you're ending with really depends on what the crop is and what its population size needs are to be healthy in the long term in terms of genetic variation, and then depends on what your selection and breeding goals are. So it's going to vary person to person, crop to crop, project to project.
How dangerous is it in a situation like the cabbage that Laurie showed? Like, say that you thought maybe that was heritable, like the three pods, or say you see like one ear of corn that you're like, oh my God, like this is exactly what I want. In both of those cases, like if you look at the charts, you want large population sizes, but you've got this like one thing, like how dangerous is it to start your breeding population from this like a single thing, you know, like you've gone way narrow, but then you're like, okay, but then I'm gonna go back up, but like you're not going to have variation, but you've got the traits that you want. So you guys are, looks like you deal with this
Jordyn, why don't you start?
Yeah, I would say two things to that, at least, maybe more things. But the first is that whenever you're doing selection, especially when you're doing something like Jay's mentioning, where you are just selecting very narrowly for something really special and you're excited this might be a new project or this might be a disaster, keep seed from prior generations on hand. So that way, if you go down that road, you realize, oh no, I've really bottlenecked this population now. You know, ooh, I really love that corn. It's really pretty, but all the plants are this tall and like make 7 seeds. Oh boy, I guess I really did inbreed this too much. You can just go back to the previous year's seed and start from there. You've only lost a year, however many years, rather than losing the whole, your whole breeding project. But Jay, you bring up a good point, which is that the numbers, when we talk about population size, they're not hard and fast. First of all, it really depends actually on the specific varieties within the crops. Some varieties are already kind of on their way towards becoming inbred, self-pollinating crops. You see this a lot in squash, where some of those squash varieties, when a lot of the, you know, modern, especially smaller squashes, they really went through an inbreeding process. And so those squashes are already kind of inbred varieties that you can say, you know, they were saved, you know, from a single plant to a single plant to a single plant for several generations. You're not going to really do much more inbreeding to it than before, compared to maybe some, you know, giant, you know, heirloom, you know, almost land race squash, that a lot of that vigor and size is because of its genetic variability. And if you start to narrow, it's going to start shrinking and getting, you know, lower yielding. And so those numbers, they don't just vary species to species, but they actually vary within the species too. The other thing is that it does actually, like, doing it for a single year versus doing it for multiple years, yeah, matters. That single plant that you're saving seed from is carrying some genetic variability from, you know, all of the plants previously. If you're talking about an ear of corn, for example, if this was an open pollinated population that you're working with, that pollen, you know, each of those seeds might have been crossed with, you know, 100 different plants in the field. And so even though you're carrying a plant that just has seeds from a single mother, there may be, you know, representing the diversity of 100 fathers on there. And so the diversity might be larger. So it does actually matter how many generations, and it matters specifically kind of what the variability coming in to the seed that you're saving, that if you're saving it from a single plant or from a small number of plants. Mm-hmm. In other words, you know, it's a different thing than if you started with 5 cabbages and 5 cabbages was all that pollinated each other and you ended up saving seed from 5 cabbages. That's a different thing than if you started with 200 cabbages, let them all cross, but only save seed from 5 of those. So
yeah,
it matters, and it'll matter how many generations you do it. You might be able to get away with it a single year, and then, like you said, Jay, blow it up to large populations again. But if you do it every year and every year and every year, it actually narrows it down more.
I feel like the other reason where I wrestle with this sometimes is when you're trying to make crosses. And so sometimes I'm just like wrestling with like I want to cross this tomato with this tomato, and, you know, maybe I try to make multiple crosses and some of them don't work. And so like you end up with like a single F1 fruit that then you're using that to start like a breeding project. I'm like, that's pretty narrow. It's like there was one mother, one father, they were inbred. So I'm like, oh, okay, you should be like doing tons of, you know, tons of crosses. I guess if they're already inbred, it doesn't matter as much, but yeah, just like that seems like another way where this, you're like go through this big bottleneck, and I'm like looking at the charts and I'm like, oh god, I'm totally violating the population chart. Is anyone watching?
Yeah, if you go to the seed garden book, and in there, that this kind of is an example of how much debate and variation and it dependsness there is to this. There's actually, I think we ended up with 3 different numbers for every crop. One that was, if you're really focusing on trying to maintain the full breadth of genetic diversity of this thing, because you're wanting to be a true, you know, preserver of this variety. There's the third one, or the second one, that was more if you want to be able to save seed for this for several generations and still have enough genetic vigor, enough hybrid vigor, basically, to, you know, keep that population healthy enough over several generations. And then I think the third one was like, if you just are saving seed for 1 year just to be able to plant it the next year, how little can you go? And so it, yeah, the answer is it's going to vary a lot. And there are these tough situations, like you said, like when you're crossing, where it's really hard to avoid bottlenecking.
Yeah.
I'm going to weigh in here. I just want to be mindful of time check, because I know that Jared's going to dive in a little bit on how you actually make populations and do some progeny selection. So some of the practical material is still to come. But while you're pulling up your screen, Jared, I'll just interject there. A couple of resources. I recommend Carol Deppy's book, How to Breed Your Own Vegetables. And I can't remember the exact title, but look at Carol Deppy's breeding book. Very inspiring on how to do it on a small scale as a backyard gardener, how to maintain a large population and achieve selection on a small footprint. And also, this highlights one of the values of working with farmers, and some of the inspiring projects I've seen starting up are between a farmer who's a seed grower breeder and a farmer who's a production breeder. This is really how Organic Seed Alliance's breeding program operates. When you're working with a farmer, not only do they know that crop, and not only are they planting it under this production environment, so you're selecting for that environment, but they also are growing a large population size. So in working with a cabbage farmer, Laurie goes out with the farmer and selects maybe 100 plants out of 1,000, which is a lot more than you can really manage on your own in a non-production environment. So with that, I'll pass it to Jared.
Thanks, Micaela. We really, for this talk, haven't talked a lot about the crossing side of things. And I would say that that's going to be something that depends on the crop. And there's so many different techniques for how to do the crosses. Some are easy, some are hard. And frankly, you don't necessarily have to do a cross to be a breeder. There are opportunities out there where you may just be starting with a population that has variability in it already. Or in the case of working with hybrid varieties, you can actually have someone made the cross for you, and you can save seed from an F1, commercial F1 hybrid, you know, if there are no patents or restrictions on it, and have a segregating variable population already there to play with. But if you're interested in how to make crosses, at the end I'll show you that we have several great resources that are kind of crop specific for some of the crops, and an overall introduction to plant breeding guide that has a lot of references for how to hybridize different crops. So I apologize, we don't talk a lot about crossing in this, but it's really a crop specific process, and it's pretty straightforward once you understand, you know, what crop you're dealing with. What I am going to be talking about is diving a little bit more into the specifics of different ways that you can do selection. In other words, different ways that you can decide which plants are you going to be saving seed from and advancing to the next generation, and which ones are you not. So the three ways I'm going to be talking about are what we're calling negative mass selection, or roguing, positive mass selection, and then progeny or family selection. Roguing or negative selection is where if you have a large field or a small field, you are ending up removing a relatively small proportion of the plants out of that field. So if you look around and you've got 100 plants and you're only taking out 5 or 10 of those plants, this is kind of considered roguing. This would be often done in a situation where your variety is mostly good enough, but you have a few things where occasionally there are off types that where it is not exactly matching what you want out of that variety or out of that breeding population. And you just want to continue to clean it up and maintain it. This is something you would be doing even just as a seed saver, this is just good practice. Good seed saving practice is to continue to remove off types, varieties that are poor performers, and so on. This is something that can be done if you're a seed producer growing seed commercially. It can be done even on a production crop where you're growing that seed for sale, because you're not losing a lot of yield from that crop. If you're going to be doing roguing or negative mass selection, this is more effective when done before the plants pollinate. So if there are traits that you can see, just like Laurie talked about, there are traits you can see before pollination happens, and you can pull those plants out of the field before their pollen spreads around, then you no longer, you're getting rid of any, not just of that, the plants, the seeds those plants can make, but any of the crosses that they might be making with the other plants in the field. It's also more effective, similarly, in self-pollinated crops than cross-pollinated crops, because those self-pollinated crops, if you remove that plant, you've removed its entire contribution to your population because it hasn't spread its pollen around. Mass selection is the same principle that we're talking about with roguing, where you are looking at individual plants in your population and deciding based on how those individual plants look, are they good enough to save seed from? Are they good enough to contribute to the next generation of your population, or do they need to be removed from the population? In this case, using the language that Laurie introduced, we're looking at the plant's phenotype. So when we see a really large, robust plant, we don't necessarily know if that's because of its genetics or because of its environment. It may be just in a really nice fertile spot of the field where there just happened to be an extra bit of compost on it, or it really might be the genetics, or it might be a combination of both of those. That's one of the challenges around mass selection, but it is a fairly simple process that allows us to work with larger populations. If you can make your field as uniform as possible, going back to what Micaela was talking about with trials, if you can make your field as uniform as possible, if you can apply all the practices, whether it's, you know, watering, fertilizing, and so on, as uniformly as possible, everything that you can do to ensure that the environment that all those plants are seeing is uniform, the better that you can feel confident when you decide this plant looks better, it really is because of the genetics and not just because of the environment. That gives you more power in your mass selection. Another trick that you can do to kind of account for this potential variation in your field is you can select from quadrants, and I'll show you what that means. If you imagine your field, there may be, for example, here a gradient where there may be a fertility gradient where you, on one corner of your field, you're starting with a nice silty loam soil and it starts to get maybe a little gravelier as you get into kind of an ancient riverbed or something like that, and the fertility goes down in your field. If you just selected strictly out of your whole field, which are the nicest looking plants, you might pick everything from the corner of the field that was the most fertile. If you force yourself to draw an imaginary grid in your field, divide it in this example into quarters and say, I will only pick an equal proportion, in this case, 5 plants from this quarter, 5 plants from this quarter, you know, the 5 best plants from this quarter and the 5 best plants from that quarter, you're more likely that to find the best plants based on their genetics. And in fact, you're more likely to find, if you're picking the nicest plants from this quarter, you're finding plants that look well even in poor conditions, which is, could be a really useful trait to be selecting for. So this is one way that you can kind of address some of the challenges of field effects or the infective environment when you're doing mass selection. But another trick and another strategy is to change over to family or progeny selection. And this is really a powerful tool that will allow you, if you have the space and the willingness, to ramp up your plant breeding efforts. Essentially, what you're doing is you're converting your seed saving and your plant breeding into a variety trial. And I'll show you the basic steps for how to do that. So we're starting with mass selection, just like before. Imagine that you have a field where all the plants are just grown from seed that you saved in no particular arrangement. You go and you select seeds, you know, select plants from that field, the best plants in that population, maybe using that quadrant approach that I talked about. But instead of combining all that seed together at the end of the season, what you're going to do is you're going to save seed from each of those plants in its own individual bag. So if you save seed from 20 plants, you're going to have 20 different bags labeled, you know, plant one, plant two, plant three, plant four, and so on from, you know, with seed from those 20 different plants. The next season, now what you're going to do is almost treat those separate little bags of seed as separate varieties and conduct what is in essence a variety trial with those. You'll plant individual short rows from each of those 20 bags. So now you have 20 rows if you, or you can even replicate this trial where you plant those seed from those 20 plants in two places so that you've got 40 rows so that each plant has its seed, its progeny, represented as a row in two different parts of your field, kind of looking like this. This only has three rows, but imagine a lot more. Now you have a lot more power to see, okay, how does this overall family, so imagine this is a row that all the seed here came from plant one. They're all related. They're all basically brothers and sisters. How do they look overall? How does this group of more related individuals, they're more related to each other than they are to these other families. How do they look? Do they look overall better or worse? Are they darker green or lighter green? Whatever the traits are that you might be trying to select for, you can kind of get a stronger sense of that trait when you're looking at a whole group of plants. And not only that, but you can look at them and start to get a sense of if there was an environmental effect, especially if you were able to replicate and grow the same family, let's say this is family one up here, but also over in another corner of the field up here. When I look at these two replications where these, you know, these six plants are growing here and up there, how do they look overall? How does this family look overall? And you start to feel more confident that if it looks good in two places across a bunch of plants, that is really because of some genetic effects, and that if I save seed from those plants, I'm going to see those same traits represented again the next generation. So going through choosing which are your best families based on the traits and which are the families that don't look as good, are less vigorous, are too late maturing, you know, are starting to show diseases and so on. Eliminate those. If you can, remove those plants before they can pollinate, for the same reason we've talked about before, because then their pollen can't contribute to the next generation. And then go through within those families and say, which out of these best families, which are the best looking plants in the best families? Those are what I want to save seed from. Remove the inferior plants or the less desirable plants from even the best families. And what I want to really caution you against is there may be in these not very good looking families, some plants that look okay. And you say, well, but I really like this plant over here in family three. Sure, the rest of the plants in this row look lousy, but that one looks good. Realize that when you're looking at all those plants together, there may be some hidden genes that good looking plant is carrying that are being expressed in its siblings and the other plants in that same family. And you should really take a clue from looking at that whole family and know that if you save seed from that, you may be carrying some of those less desirable traits that will get expressed the next year. So ideally, start by getting rid of those families, those poor families, and only save the best seed from save seed from the best plants and the best families. Then at that point, you can take that seed and either take that seed and continue this process. So now you've got these, in this case, you've got these three plants here from this family. Save seed from each of those individually and have three rows that will be for next year, along with whichever other families you save seed for from. Or if you liked what you found and you're ready to say, I'm done with managing all these separate families, now you can bulk those together and return back to mass selection. I realized that I actually have the wrong slideshow open, and I wanted to mention a couple of comparisons between family and mass selection. So bear with me here for a second while I switch over to another slideshow. Let's see, I need to move this out of the way so I can get to it. Let's see, this one has the comparisons. So a few kind of summary comparisons between mass selection and progeny selection. Mass selection in general tends to make slower progress because you have all you're not able to see some of the negative or less desirable genetics that's being carried along either as recessive traits or because you're having a hard time separating out the effect of the environment from the actual genetics. Family selection in general lets you make faster progress. Mass selection is easier. There's less to manage. You don't have separate rows. You just have a whole field. Mass selection can be good for simple traits that are easy to see. In particular, it can be good for recessive traits. If there's something that is a recessive gene, which means that you'll only see it if that plant is actually carrying a copy of that gene from both the male and female side. If you are trying to select for a recessive trait, if you see a plant that has that trait, that means it actually has gene. It has those genes coming from both its both the maternal and paternal sides of it. And so if you save seed from it, it will also pass it on. So it's actually better for simple and specifically simple recessive traits. Whereas family selection, because you're growing big families, it gives you a little more insight into some of the hidden genetics, some of the things that might be being carried as one recessive and one dominant trait. And I know we didn't get into a lot of the details of genetics, but families will let you see more of what's happening with that genetics. Mass selection doesn't require record keeping. Family selection may or may not require a lot of written record keeping, but you are very at least having to manage a whole bunch of separate little bags or packets of seed and carrying that forward generation to generation. Mass selection lets you grow larger populations in general because you're not having to maintain separate rows. And whereas with family selection, you're limited in how many of those families you can actually be growing because each of those families requires maybe 5, maybe 10, maybe 20 or more plants within its family. So you're going to be limited to how many families you can grow. So those are some of the differences between those. And there are different reasons why you may or may not want to do it with your specific project or specific points in your project. Referring back to what I mentioned earlier, when you're getting into breeding, it can feel overwhelming, but Organic Seed Alliance has a lot of resources that are available to help. We have a general introduction to organic plant breeding, as well as how to breed for organic agriculture for a lot of specific crops here, including sweet corn, tomatoes, carrots, and we also have some of them translated into Spanish there. And we have a lot of video recordings from our past seed conferences diving into the details of different breeding techniques and different crop-specific breeding plans. So check those out. At that point, I'd like to open it up to questions and remind everyone, if you'd like to hear more about breeding and learn about Organic Seed Alliance's breeding projects, find out how you might be able to get involved in those, you can sign up for our newsletter and find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and by email. So at this point, I'd like to open it up if there are more questions.
All right. The one question that we did have come in was someone asking about the influence of male pollen in corn on the endosperm. So I suggested that they look into Zinnia, I don't know if I'm saying that right, but wondering if you might want to say a little bit about that. And if you guys, if there are any other examples you can think of where you can, you know, tell that something is crossed in a way you either do or don't want, and that, you know, actually looking at the seed or the fruit of where the cross has occurred.
Yeah. So first off, corn is the zinnia effect means this is an effect where the pollen, you can actually see the influence from the pollen parent on the seed itself in that generation right after it's crossed. And it's really an unusual situation. In general, you don't know if you're growing beans, for example, and you made crosses, or maybe it was an outcrossing type bean, you know, runner bean or something. You don't know just by looking at the seed coat of that bean what its pollen source was. The coat, the seed coat of it, the look of that seed, it's entirely just influenced by the maternal plant, by the plant that you're saving seed from. You won't know anything till the next generation. That's the rule 99% of the time. With corn, you have this exception where you can actually see certain seed traits, certain endosperm traits, that very first generation. So for example, if you're growing a white corn and you see purple kernels, that actually came from pollen that, you know, came from, you know, maybe an accidental outcross, or if it maybe an intentional outcross, but it was actually from that very generation. And so that's a really neat opportunity where you can actually do some kernel selection in corn and say, I am selecting for this seed color, or maybe in the case of something like sweet corn, you're looking for a, you know, shrunken type endosperm, and, you know, you can see, is it shrunken or is it not? And you can see that very first generation and save the seed specifically, and not without having to grow it out again to know if you've made the cross or not. The only other example that I know of, and I'm curious to hear what Laurie and Micaela have others, is in peppers. My understanding is that the pungency, the spiciness in peppers is it comes from, you know, tissue from the pollen tube. And so that actually is paternal, you know, influenced by the pollen parent. And so you could actually taste if there's been spiciness crossed into a sweet pepper in that very first generation without growing it out.
Those are the only two examples I know.
Yeah, me too.
That pepper one's a good one. That makes for some interesting surprises sometimes, huh?
Certainly can.
Well, thank you guys so much. I think you guys, you know, mentioned the resources of your website. You guys have I don't know, how many series of webinars do you have now on eOrganic that are, you know, a great place to kind of, you know, this was like the brief intro, but like multiple part series that are available for free on eOrganic. Folks wanting to delve into this might want to check out.
Yeah, Jay, can we post a few resources with the archived YouTube then later? And Carol Deppi's book is How to Breed Your Own Vegetables. So we could add that, a link to that.
Yeah.
Book as well.
Which, yeah, it's a really, yeah, inspirational and amazing book that I think basically any of us who are interested in this were inspired by long ago. So yeah, looks like we're right on time. Does anybody have any parting thoughts for folks?
Yeah, one thing I always kind of want to tell people is, often going back to that discussion about population size and how many plants and how many seeds, it's really all a little bit of a guessing game and a risk tolerance management. And we err on the side of caution and try to prioritize, you know, we really feel like if you do this, you will get something healthy and sustainable. And that said, there are exceptions. And sometimes you can get something really wonderful from a single plant or a single fruit or a single cross. And, you know, as Jared said, it's good to keep some in reserve so you can always kind of go back and restart from the middle of something. But I also just want to say, don't let that stop you. Because there are some great stories of people. I know there's a jalapeno variety called Pizza. And somebody told me that was a breeder who literally found a jalapeno in a salad bar at a pizza joint that was really good. So he took some seed home and bred a variety out of it. And, you know, it's certainly not going to work every time. You're not always going to know what's in the background of things, and it's not always going to be a gold mine, but sometimes it will be. A great quick example of that is Frank Morton and his pepper breeding. He worked with a farmer who came to him and said, I love this hybrid. It's going away. I can't get any more seed. Can you breed out of it? He'd never bred peppers before. He worked in self-pollinating lettuce and greens for most of his seed career. And he said, sure. And he just kind of went with it and made decisions that seemed as good as he could be as he went along. And now I think he has like 12 or 14 commercial varieties that he's bred out of it that are really good. So good luck, have fun, take some risks, do something that seems cool, and maybe it'll be work and be awesome.
You're totally reminding me of, and maybe we'll put this in the archived edition to the Aussie podcast. What's it called? You know what I'm talking about? The Open Source Seed Initiative podcast, yeah. Where they do interviews with, you know, breeders like Edmund Frost, yeah. Like, how do you make this? And it's, you know, it's exactly what you're saying. It's always the story from a lot of these folks are just do it, just go for it. And like, you'll figure it out along the way, and yeah. Some stuff won't work out, but you'll have these ones that turn into gems. So, yeah, it's the more you start doing it, the more all of this stuff makes some sense, and you just keep learning it and learning it and learning. But if you just try to like abstractly learn it first, before you start, it's not going to work.
Yeah. And that can be scary and frustrating, and do it anyways.
Yeah.
Right. If you start now, it gives you, if you start now, it gives you more years to get better and more years to improve it. You only have so many years, so many generations to do your breeding. So the sooner you start it, the farther you can get.
Yeah. And share with others.
Yeah. Well, good seeing you all. Have a great rest of your day. Variety Showcase will be continuing live the rest of this week. So tune back in, and thanks everybody for joining us. And thanks those of you that are watching this archived later on. Hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah, and Michaela and I will be back tomorrow at 11 with Dr. Phil Simon and our friend Jess Reet to talk about carrots and talk more about those super fun colored carrots. So we'll see you, the two of us will see you tomorrow as well.
Awesome. All right, guys. Take care. Bye.